Welcome to the Steel City, where today's college football game on ESPNU is presented in high definition. LeSean McCoy, the biggest man on campus, leads the 25th-ranked Pitt Panthers into Heinz Field to take on Bowling Green. Wave the flag into another college football season. College football presented by Allstate on ESPNU. And today here at Heinz Field, it's the 25th-ranked Pitt Panthers taking on Bowling Green. Well, hi again, everyone. I'm Dave Armstrong. And the people here in Pittsburgh are as tough as the steel they forge in their factories. But they're also tired. Tired of 3 years of losing football. And then last year, in the last game of the year for Pitt, they go to West Virginia to take on the mighty Mountaineers, a team that was ready to have their ticket punched to a national title game. Instead, it was the Panthers who pulled off one of the biggest upsets in the college football season. Now the question begs to be asked, can what they did on that night in West Virginia carry over into the 2008 campaign? I'm joined now by Larry Coker, the former head coach of the Miami Hurricane, and Coach Dave Wonstadt has come up with a two-word mantra for this year's team, prove it. There's one guy that doesn't need to prove anything, though, and that's LeSean McCoy.
LeSean McCoy burst onto the scenes a year ago as one of the top backs in the Big East Conference. Not only that, he's also one of the top backs in America. And I think the thing that impresses me the most about LeSean McCoy is consistency. He has his best games against the toughest competition. Look forward to seeing him play today.
Coach, you talk about him playing big in big games. In that upset of West Virginia, he ran 38 times for 148 yards. But Pitt, a tough opponent today in Bowling Green. Greg Brandon brings his team in here today, and the Falcons are coming off a bowl game of their own, and not only that, but 8 wins. Well, Coach, we'll work on your microphone and get you involved in this broadcast in a second. But for right now, that is not working. What is working is a beautiful day here in Pittsburgh. A day where the clouds have parted and the sun is shining. Who will it shine brightest on? Will it be Bowling Green or will it be these Pitt Panthers? Back deep to get it for Pitt is LaRod Stevens-Holling, a man who had to give way to the freshman sensation LeSean McCoy last year. A brief history between these two teams. Pitt won both games in 99 and then again in 2000. Vervillo will kick things off for the Falcons. A light wind coming out of the west of just 5 miles per hour. And the college football season is underway. It'll be Stevens-Holling taking it at the 11. Finds a little bit of a seam and gets it up shy of the 30, up to the 28, an 18-yard return. So here come the Panthers offensively, led now by their quarterback, Bill Stoll, who coached last year, only played 3/4 of a game.
Bill Stoll, I think he's a veteran. He's not a veteran. Dave Wonstadt knows that, and the staff knows that. He's played, started one game, was injured. He's been here 3 years. I really like Bill. I think he's got excellent potential, but the potential's not been proven yet.
So everybody's saying, oh, the quarterback situation is settled. Hold on a second. It's not necessarily settled, but certainly the makeup of this kid is great. On play action, Stoll to throw it, and he's got his receiver. That's Derek Kinder, another guy who is back from injury. He missed all last season as well. Well, let's look at the starting lineups on four of the Panthers, the backs and receivers. Of course, a lot of attention on LeSean McCoy, but we just saw Kinder, who is back after an all-Big East campaign in 06. And the big question mark, the biggest question mark for the Panthers, this offensive line. They have to replace a lot of guys up front. In fact, the only returning starter is C.J. Davis, but he's a 4-year starter at left guard. Second and just 3. The give this time is to McCoy, and he is hit hard right near the line of scrimmage. So let's look at that front four for the Falcons, and they are joined there by Dyrell Briggs, who was All-MAC last year, first-team All-MAC, and he's on the Nagurski watch list. The leading tackler at linebacker for the Falcons, Eric Dozier. Dozier had 112 tackles a year ago. The secondary is solid. 7 interceptions for P.J. Mahone. That's a new Bowling Green record. Third and less than one. A little bit of a move in the line of scrimmage will allow them to move the chains. And one of the things that Bowling Green coach, they told us before this game, we have got to stop the run.
They're going to put as many people as they need to in the box to stop the run. Here's showing a nice little run by LaShawn McCoy, a great effort. But look at Bowling Green. Look at all the people at the line of scrimmage. A nice job, nice breakout tackle.
So McCoy's yards will be tough to get today against 8, sometimes 9 guys in the box for the Falcons. Fresh set of downs for Pitt. And the pass out to the flat, caught there by Dickerson. Mahone was right there to wrap him up after a gain of about 4 or 5.
I really like what they're doing offensively. They're really giving Stahl a chance to get his feet on the ground and run a couple of times. Some nice, easy, high-percentage passes. I like that. And you mentioned the offensive line. Tony Wise, the offensive line coach for Pittsburgh, is one of the best in the country at bringing kids together and making a solid offensive line.
Well, the offensive line, we mentioned Davis, the only returning starter, Malecki. He was moved from nose guard. Here's McCoy again. And this time he gets it up to midfield. It'll bring up a third and short.
Watch McCoy here as he attacks the line of scrimmage. Watch him lower his head. Powerful runner. Not really impressive. A 3-yard gain, but that's going to wear on as the day wears on. It's going to be a hot day, a physical day. In the second half, third and fourth quarter, you're going to see McCoy really being hard to stop.
One of the things they say about McCoy, Coach, he is stronger and smarter this year. Here is a third down play, third and a short 3. Pass out to the flat. It's caught. It's a first down and then much more. Fighting for extra yards is Nate Byam, the tight end.
Pittsburgh going to use their tight end. That's a great job by Bynum. And nice. Again, the throws by Stahl. One thing that they talked about was his accuracy. Very accurate throw. Very easily caught ball. And a nice job breaking tackle by Nate Bynum, the tight end.
Bynum a gain of 10 here. It's Stahl, by the way, 3 for 3 to begin the game.
Great start and a great job to offensive coordinator Matt Cavanaugh.
Right now, Dave Wanstead and Matt Cavanaugh are just glad to see the ball in their receiver's hands. What a move by McCoy! There he goes down the sideline! That's actually LaRod Stevens-Holling. Subbing for McCoy as Stevens-Holling with a big run. They had McCoy and Stevens-Holling lined up in the backfield together.
They were going to do that some. Stevens-Holling is actually faster than McCoy, and I've heard people say that no Pitt, that the two best players on Pittsburgh's teams are the two running backs. Great job by Stevens-Holling.
A 27-yard run here by Stevens-Holling.
Most of it was on him, a nice break and a nice move.
Just outside the 10. He'll get a breather, Stevens-Holling. Now McCoy again. Little stutter step. He's got some room. Into the end zone. Touchdown. What a move by McCoy.
What a great run in the open field. Should have been a 1-yard gain at the most. The great ones make somebody miss, and obviously McCoy did. Made almost the entire Bowling Green secondary miss on that one. It's really a tough start for Bowling Green. I think exactly what Pittsburgh wants to do to start this game and set the tempo for this football game.
Boy, Pitt averaged just under 23 points a game last year. You wouldn't know it by looking at that drive. That was impressive.
Well, a good mixture of play calling by Mike Cavanaugh. Good mixture and really a good job of execution.
The extra point automatic from Mr. Perfect, Connor Lee, who has not missed one in his career. He's 76 for 76. The beat goes on. LaShawn McCoy, who scored 14 times last year, gets hit on the board. It's 7-0. ESPNU now available in high definition. To get the great action on ESPNU in high definition, contact your local cable operator or satellite provider. ESPNU HD, the big picture in college sports. So here we come to you from the Three Rivers City. The Allegheny and the Monongahela forming the Ohio River right there at that confluence. And we welcome you into Heinz Field with Larry Coker. I'm Dave Armstrong. Glad to have you with us for the start of this college football season. And what an impressive start for the Pitt Panthers.
Exactly like they wanted to start it. And great drive, eight plays, touchdown. You know, in a game like this, Pittsburgh's favored. They just need to set the tone.
They did. Connor Lee to kick things off. Roger Williams takes it at the five. Williams, a nice little run as he gets it up to the 25, a return of 20. So here come the Falcons, and Tyler Sheehan is their quarterback. What a good job he did throwing for over 3,000 yards a year ago.
Right, his first year to start, very efficient, 3,000 yards, 23 touchdowns, very efficient. But today, he's going to have to be more than just efficient. He's going to have to make plays and be a big playmaker for his offense.
He threw 11 interceptions last year, Coach, but only two interceptions in the last seven games and no interceptions in the last 108 pass attempts.
Five of those were against Boston College.
First down for Bowling Green at their own 26 from the shotgun. From the spread formation, knocked down at the line of scrimmage. Big play there defensively by big number 95, Mick Williams. So here are the backs and receivers, and really more receivers than backs. Bullock and Turner, Partridge is back after an injury a year ago. Freddie Barnes, their leading receiver. And again, the offensive line, a big question mark for Bowling Green. They have to replace their center and both tackles. Their center, a left-handed redshirt freshman, Ben Poychek. A left-handed center, that's about as rare as a left-handed catcher in baseball. Sheehan throws on the run. He's got his receiver wide open. Partridge along the side. Someone missed coverage, and Partridge will move the chains as he gains 11. Here's the defense for the Pitt Panthers. Up front, we just saw Mick Williams make a nice play. Rashad Duncan is up there along with Romeus. The linebackers, all you need to know is Scott McKillop is back, the leading tackler in the nation from a year ago. And in the secondary, they're solid, but they don't have many picks. Only three picks amongst that four all year long. And that's one of the things that's a point of emphasis this year. There's a run by Bullock as we get you to Lowell Galindo for our first update of the day.
Guys, thank you so much. Andrew Hatch got the starting quarterback for LSU, built up an early lead for the Bayou Bengals. Then Jarrett Lee, the redshirt freshman out of Texas, comes in, hitting a wide-open Brandon LaFell, 31 yards, and no upset here. LSU up 24-0 over App State.
Welcome back, and what we just saw here was another big play by Mick Williams, who's had a great camp, and two big defensive plays on this drive.
Well, this is rare versus a Greg Brandon spread offense to get a sack, because Sheehan does a great job getting the ball out of his hands, but that's just great pass pressure, and certainly a great job by Mick Williams.
He averaged just three sacks a game last year, the Panthers. So a loss of 11 backs him way up. Third and long. Sheehan with time this time. Fires it across the middle. And is it picked off? It is! An interception. Austin Ransom, who a week ago, folks, was a wide receiver. A week ago.
Well, this is unbelievable for him to move out and be a linebacker. But what a great start for him, a great confidence builder. And I know the Pitt coaches have a lot of confidence in him. And what a phenomenal play. You've seen the Bowling Green offense out of rhythm, and that's not what they want to do. They want to be high percentage. They want to have positive plays. They didn't have that on that series, obviously.
Well, you wonder what Sheehan was throwing to there, because there were two guys there for Pitt. So Pitt takes over after the turnover. Good field position. Stoll moves up in the pocket. Now Stoll's going to run for it and get basically back to the line of scrimmage, maybe a gain of about one. So it won't be a sack as Stoll gets past the line.
Really a nice job by Stoll moving up in the pocket, because he had pressure. You don't worry about pressure, but you sense it. The good ones know where it's coming from. He was sliding up in the pocket. A nice job there. Again, not a big game, but certainly not a negative play.
Pitt already leading 7-0. Now the turnover, the interception by Ransom. Very few interceptions last year for Pitt. One of the worst as far as turnovers and takeaways last year. There's McCoy dancing around, a short gain. He gets it down to the 35-yard line, where it'll bring up about third and seven.
Well, that's what you have to do. You have to be able to tackle, and really a nice tackle on LeSean McCoy, and Bowling Green needs to settle in. This is a very big series for the Falcons because great field position by Pitt. Bowling Green needs to hold the Pitt Panthers this series, hopefully to a field goal from their standpoint.
Or nothing.
Let's or
see
nothing.
What happens on this play. Third and seven. Stall back to throw. He had his man on the wing. That was by him, but he couldn't hang on to the ball. Excuse me, that was Oderick Turner, who couldn't hang on to it. Remember, Turner missed a couple of last year. They said in fall drills he had surer hands, but that one he dropped.
That was a drop. That should have been a catch. Now, a 52-yard field goal attempt, and they decided to go that route. Let's see what decision Dave Wanstead makes here.
Like he's bringing the punting team out as Dave Brightest, the punter, comes out onto the field. They're going to try to pin Bowling Green back. So if you're the Falcons right now, that's a good series defensively.
If you're the Bowling Green Falcons, you feel great about that series.
Oh, yeah.
Because it took the momentum away from Pittsburgh a little bit. Get it back on their side.
Wide formation on these punts. Brightest gets it off, trying to hit the corner, and it'll go into the end zone. So a net punt there of only 15 yards. They'll bring it out to the 20-yard line. Pitt gets the turnover, doesn't take advantage. Still 7-0 Panthers. We welcome you back to Heinz Field, where Pitt, on the strength of a 12-yard touchdown run from LeSean McCoy, leading 7-0. Coming up right after our game on ESPNU High Def, it's the Delaware Blue Hens taking on the Maryland Terrapins. ESPNU College Football presented by Allstate at 3:45 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. So Bowling Green's defense stiffens just a little bit. Doesn't allow Pitt to tack on any more points. Now here they come offensively, and no room to run there at all. Freddie Barnes, who had positioned himself as a slot back, gets no gain. In fact, he lost a yard.
Freddie Barnes is a very versatile player. He plays wide receiver, slot back, and there as a direct snap. Pitt defense is very fast. This is an outstanding defensive football team. There's some things they need to work on, and we'll talk about those later.
Those offensive numbers haven't kicked in yet for Bowling Green. Look at that, just 2 yards on the day. This is their second possession. Sheehan. Good coverage, incomplete. Boy, excellent coverage out there on the wing. As Aaron Berry, one of the best cover guys for Pitt, was right there stride for stride with the receiver.
Well, Berry is really their shut down corner, and he shut it down at that time because that was a great job on coverage.
Third down, back up, 11.
So third and 11 again. Seems like it's been third and long a lot for the Falcons already. Sheehan sensed a blitz coming, checks off. The blitz is still coming. He's able to unload in a hurry, and the pass is off the hands of Barnes, incomplete. Right now, Bowling Green looks out of sync.
They're totally out of sync, and Pittsburgh looks very good on defense. They look very aggressive, very confident. And Phil Bennett, always the new coordinator, talks about alignment and knowledge, and this defense right now has knowledge. These mismatches haven't occurred that Bowling Green needs.
So after three plays, a loss of one, that brings out the punting unit. Iovanelli will be punting it. And back deep to get it is Aaron Berry, a junior. He's awaiting his own 40. High punt. Berry is going to call for the fair catch. And then he lost it in the sun. This ball is going to be downed at the 1 yard line after Berry lost the ball in the sun.
What a huge mistake. What a huge mistake in special teams.
At least he didn't touch the ball. That would have been worse.
You've got to feel the punch.
ESPNU College Football is presented by Allstate. Proud sponsors of college football. Are you in good hands? And in part by eHarmony.com. Are you ready to fall in love? Well, Bowling Green certainly fell in love with that punt as Pittsburgh backed up the shadows of their own goalpost. They lead 7-0, but will start this drive at their own 2-yard line. College football presented by Allstate on ESPNU. I have heard of wind-aided punts before, but never one that was sun-aided. And this one thrown away. Good decision here by Bill Stahl as we get you in to Lowell Galindo for another update from SportsCenter U.
Yeah, and this time it's the anti-LeSean McCoy. P.J. Hill just bruising his way. 8 rushes, 97 yards in the first half. Wisconsin up on Akron 14-0.
Thank you, Lowell. Again, it's Pitt backed up at their own 2-yard line, now 2nd and 10. Kinder comes in motion. McCoy, quick little move behind the line of scrimmage, gets it up to the 5.
Matt Cavanaugh showing a lot of confidence in Bill Stahl, though. First down out of your own end zone, throwing the football. Obviously, it wasn't successful, but I think that was an important call.
And now a player is down and injured, it would appear, for Bowling Green. It looks like it's Nick Teresso. Backup nose tackle.
Depth is going to be a factor today because it is a hot day in Pittsburgh. It is a sunny day. And that should be an advantage to Pittsburgh, but I think depth will be a situation we'll have to keep our eye on.
One of the things that Greg Brandon told us coming into this game was they have a very, very tough non-conference schedule before they get into the MAC, starting here at Pitt, then Minnesota, then at Boise State, and at Wyoming. And he's hoping to get through those 4 games pretty much unscathed. This isn't something he needed to see.
Well, it really isn't. He was picked to win the Eastern Division of the MAC Conference, which is certainly a tough division.
Yeah.
So, but coming through 4 games, you need to see some progress and some good things happen. Maybe upset somebody. A year ago, they beat the Golden Gophers of Minnesota in the first football game. Certainly, it's a long, long game left to go, but I think Bowling Green needs to get some rhythm and needs to get back in control of this football game.
You know, the MAC, you talked about them being favored to win the East. So much experience coming back in the MAC this year. In fact, every MAC team this year will return at least 13 starters.
Well, it'll be an exciting season for the MAC then. It'll be anybody can win on any Saturday, and I think Bowling Green knows that. Great tradition of football at Bowling Green. And I think you're going to see them really, really, after this first 3-4 football game, see what they're made of.
Again, Nick Teresso, he goes down. 2 interior linemen, by the way, were forced off the roster due to some off-the-field activity in the offseason. So now with Teresso going down, this sophomore out of Chicago, again, depth is going to be a concern for the Falcons.
It really will. And obviously, you want your players to do the right things in the offseason, which is it's a long offseason. You know, your players, if they make mistakes and the coach has to discipline them, sometimes a first game, maybe a second game, that you force that player to miss.
Well, as Teresso gets helped up and off the field, crowd here at Pittsburgh wishing him the best. We invite you to log on to your online source for all things college sports, ESPNU.com. It's an online service. It's your gateway to all college sports content from ESPN. Combining the latest news with an expanded collection of exclusive material, scores, columns, video and audio highlights, podcasts, you name it, we've got it. It's ESPNU.com. I know Coach Coker has that bookmarked on his own laptop.
It is right there, easy to find, easy access.
So Teresso slowly walks off the field, being helped by a couple of the trainers.
Doesn't look good for his return today, but hopefully he'll be fine and back later in the season.
Well, right now it's back to the game, and Pitt is facing a 3rd and 7 from their own 5.
Big play for the Bowling Green defense to hold Pitt here and get some field position.
Again, the reason they're backed up so far, a punt lost in the sun. Spread formation for Pitt. Quick drop by Stahl. He's got his receiver and enough for the first down. A throw out to the flat to Turner. And that time, Turner held on.
A nice job. Again, 4 wide receivers. Really a good job by Stahl setting up in the pocket. And nice protection by the young Pittsburgh offensive line. Really nice setup by Stahl.
10-yard gain there to move the chains. They needed 7 now out to the 15-yard line. Remember, on the first drive for Pitt, they went 8 plays, 71 yards, capped by a 12-yard touchdown run by LeSean McCoy. Play action. Stahl. good on-target throw, this time to Derek Kinder. And now we get you to another studio update with Lowell Galindo.
Guys, a standing O in Columbus, Ohio. Why? Because Terrell Pryor, his first career play in the Scarlet and Gray, a 9-yard pass to Jamel Hines. He is 2-2 on the day passing, still in the game. They are leading this one 10-0 over Youngstown State.
Ohio State not expected to get much of a challenge from Tressel's old team. First down here. Here comes Rod Stevens Holling. Another big play by Stevens Holling up to the 39.
Up near the 40. And a first down.
What? Yes, please. I tell you, what a nice job there with him. Just a nice move at the line of scrimmage to make somebody miss. And you can just see, watch him run in. And you can see the speed. Probably better speed than McCoy has. Very elusive. Doesn't have the size and strength McCoy has. This is going to be quite a combination of backs for Pitt as this season progresses.
13-yard gain there. Remember his bigger run of 27 yards on the first drive. So they move the chains again. Again, play action. Stall again. This time a little bit off target. Slipping out there was Doran Dickerson as he made his cut.
You look at Stall a little bit on his body language there. I think he feels like he should have had that pass. That should have been in completion. He's been very impressive. Matt Cavanaugh is doing a good job with play action and short drops to help this young offensive line protect for Stull.
He looks like he's mixing it up, Cavanaugh. I mean, he's not just coming out and run, but they're mixing up the pass and run very well so far.
Well, play caller, I think the quarterback and the execution has a lot to do with that. Matt Cavanaugh is going to call things that these guys can do and do well.
Second and 10. This is the eighth play of this drive already. Looks like that could be offside, our first flag of the day. So forget what you just saw as far as the run, because this will be offsides on Bowling Green. Our referee today.
Offside. 99 on the defense. 5-yard penalty. Replay second down.
Randy Smith from an all Big East crew.
Well, I think that you said the first penalty in the first game of the year. Normally you're going to see a lot of penalties. Hopefully we don't. But that says a lot for the coaching of both of these teams.
You're always nervous that first game, aren't you? You know, you've watched fall practice, you've gone through spring drills. That first game is always something that gets everyone's attention.
You're not nervous, you're terrified.
Second now and 5. A helmet comes flying, and so does Stevens Holling. Another big run. His third big gain of the day. 21 that time.
Watch the cut. Nice job there. Bowling Green is putting the eighth guy in the box, but they're not keeping leverage. They're allowing Stevens Holly outside. You cannot break down. You cannot lose leverage. You've got to turn the running back to the defense.
Already off to a great start. Rod Stevens Holly, who sometimes is the forgotten factor in that backfield.
I don't think he's forgotten by their opponents because everybody knows about him, and it doesn't make it a lot easier. I know when I was at Oklahoma State, we had Thurman Thomas was our starting running back, and our backup was Barry Sanders. So
that's not a bad backup.
Not a bad backup. I don't think Stephen Tolley's a bad backup either for Pitt.
Well, one of the officials went down on that last play. So we have an official timeout. See, had Thurman Thomas and Barry Sanders in the same backfield. Not bad.
No, it's not a bad. I was one of the better years I had coaching when I had both those guys.
I would think so, yeah.
I caught a lot of good plays that year.
Yeah, as an offensive coordinator of the Cowboys, you couldn't miss.
No.
First down here for Pitt at the 40-yard line of Bowling Green. Quick hitter to the outside. Pass actually behind the receiver, Cedric McGee, and that kind of busted up the play.
Well, it did. What a great catch, though. Nice hands by McGee. He was, 2 years ago, was the all Big East receiver, and it's very, very impressive.
Well, his uncle is Michael Irvin, so he got his hands naturally.
Well, he did, yeah, from South Florida, actually. Fort Lauderdale.
Well, a loss there of 1 on the play. Makes it 2nd and 11. Stull, so far from what we've seen, he looks pretty solid. I mean, shaking off the rust of a missed year.
He looks very solid to me. I'm very impressed with Stull thus far.
2nd and 11. Stull straight back. Deep drop. And he's got Kinder coming across the field, and Kinder forced out of bounds at the 33-yard line.
Well, Kinder missed the entire year last year, and how happy they are to have him back. What a weapon that Kinder is. And you're right about Stahl. He's very comfortable. And I know Matt Cavanaugh said one thing about Stahl. He throws things that are catchable. And everything he's thrown today has just about been perfect.
Kinder, they were telling us just about 2 or 3 weeks ago, he finally took off the knee brace and felt like he was confident enough. And sometimes, Coach, it's that mental hurdle that the players have to get past.
Well, surgeries are so good anymore. I think the mental hurdle is probably the biggest thing to get over.
So third and short. Uh-oh. Big play here defensively for Michael Ream. Boy, did he read that play and into the backfield to stop McCoy.
That was a great defensive call because they blitzed right into the run. They pretty well had Pitt defense that time. Nice defensive call. And then also with a good call, you had good execution because a very, very nice tackle.
Well, the punt team will come back out. Remember, they're faced with this same scenario just on their last possession after they had the interception and now forced to punt here on 4th and 6 from the 35.
That is. It's like Groundhog Day. The same situation again. But really a good job of the Pitt offense to at least get some field position, even though they didn't score.
Brightus will again try to find the corner. This looks like it has a better chance, and it does. It is taken down at the 5-yard line. Coach, one of the nuances in rule changes this year is the play clock is a little bit different, and they're hoping to speed the game up just a little bit.
Well, there's so many college football games. They do want to speed it up. It's a 40-second clock. It's much like the NFL has. There are some differences because you still have a 25-second play clock that you have to deal with. But the 40-second clock, much like the NFL, and again, they hope to speed the game up. With a no-huddle offense, I don't know that it'll matter that much.
Now, remember, this doesn't apply for the last 2 minutes of each half.
The hardest thing about the new play clock rules is someone to operate the clocks.
Yeah, that's true.
It's different.
Running from a pocket and incomplete intended for Parks, and the ball hit the ground first. So now you see the play clock. Again, that's an incomplete pass, and they start the 40-second play clock immediately.
A difference is a year ago, the play clock would not start until the snap of the football on an incomplete pass. Now it's the 40-second clock. It's running, again, like the NFL does it.
I like it better, don't you?
I never had it. I don't know. I'm gonna know after this year, probably after a couple of games.
And again, no problem getting the playoff inside 10 yards. No room to run inside. Boy, that defensive front four for the Panthers, so solid. And again, you see the play clock again immediately starts as soon as the play is blown dead.
Right, it's going 40 seconds, 39, 38. It's running now as we speak.
So facing now a 3rd and 10. Play coming in from the sideline to Sheehan. This Pitt defense has been really solid so far today.
We expected them to be good, but they are very, very good thus far.
Sheehan from his own end zone. Little pass across the middle. It'll be well shy of the first down marker. Turner's got it, but only a gain of about 3 or 4.
That's the pass they want to throw on first down. They would like to have that 3 or 4 yard gain to make it 2nd and 5, 2nd and 6. But again, they're getting out of rhythm. They're getting the 3rd and longs and not converting.
So the defense comes through once again and forces yet another punt. And the new defensive coordinator there, you see Phil Bennett, who is urging his team on from the sideline. Boy, they got a great defensive coordinator, didn't they?
They really did. Phil Bennett is an outstanding defensive coach, a great background, and really has done a great job of defense wherever he's been.
Former head coach at SMU. Short punt this time, and this time Barry doesn't lose it in the sun. Now dancing around looking for some room outside. And Barry, with a return of 9, gets it down to the 41-yard line. Great field position. Well, Bennett's defense so far today has been stellar.
Well, again, he's an outstanding defensive football coach, and he really likes it. It's a good defense coming back for Pitt from a year ago. Some things they weren't good at was some red zone defense. I think that's something he wants to improve on, and also scoring defense. scoring defense looks pretty good right now.
Certainly does. And the takeaways, only 11 fumbles, 8 interceptions. They already have an interception today. And so far, they've held Bowling Green. Remember, this is an offense that scored better than 30 points a game last year. They've held them to just 6 yards so far in this first quarter. Dancing there for McCoy. He dances across the 40 down to the 37-yard line.
Still really a nice tackle by the Bowling Green safeties. They're feeling nice, and really that's the key they have to be able to do. They have to be able to tackle from the secondary.
You think McCoy feels like he's got a huge target on his back today?
Well, you know what? That's going to be interesting for him for the entire year. He was really kind of a nobody last year. He had to prove himself now. Everybody knows who he is. He's going to have a target every Saturday.
We'll have to become accustomed to that. Second and 7. And again, McCoy trying to get outside, and again, with that 8 in the box, very tough for him to get outside. Good tackle in there by Antonio Smith. And that's the end of the first quarter. We're back to Pittsburgh in just a moment. ESPNU is now available at high definition to get the great action on ESPNU in high def. Contact your local cable operator or satellite provider, ESPNU HD, the big picture in college sports. The big picture today from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where the Panthers lead 7-0 with Larry Coker. I'm Dave Armstrong here at Heinz Field, where Pitt facing a 3rd and 5, and so far today they're 3 of 5 on 3rd down. A draw play, and it'll be shy of the first down marker. They get inside the 35-yard line as we get you back to Lowell Galindo for another update.
Fellas, this really could go down as the year of the true freshman for Georgia, A.J. Green. The number 2 wide receiver in the ESPNU 150 class of 2008. His first catch sets up a no Sean Marino touchdown.
Last year it was LaShawn McCoy, the freshman. A lot of freshmen this year that are ready to break out. Well, 4th down, and this time Pitt's going to go for it. Little toss. Trying to give McCoy some room to run. He runs out of bounds. Enough for the 1st down at the 30. He knew right where he needed to go.
He knew where he needed to go, and again, that's a big play. They got in that no man's land, too far for a field goal. They don't want to punt again. And you see McCoy here, a little misdirection play. Fake the toss and then pitch to McCoy, going to the wide side, and show some nice speed. He exactly knew where he needed to go.
That really became a foot race out there, didn't it?
Yeah, and McCoy's going to win most of those.
I would think so. So a fresh set of downs for Pitt. 1st down at the 30-yard line. Pitt scoring on their opening drive. This time another hitter as McCoy goes across the right side, pushes the pile ahead for 4.
I like what he did then. LaShawn really stuck it up in tough. He made 4. Not that impressive, but a 4-yard gain. You're going to win virtually every game if you make a 4-yard gain on first downs.
You see McCoy, 11 rushes, only 33 yards, whereas Stevens Howling, just 4 rushes, and he's had 3 big runs.
Well, 33 yards, but you multiply that times to 4, and you get a nice 100-yard gain. You got Stevens Howling contributing. That's a really nice 1-2 punch.
Offense has really gone to McCoy, and now they stay on the ground, this time to their fullback, Collins. They want to run him about 10 times today. Everybody says, you know, Collins coming out of high school, coach. He ran for over 4,300 yards in high school, but here he's asked to be a great fullback.
Well, they don't need him at running back. They need him at fullback, and really a nice run by Condridge Collins. He can be a running back for a lot of people. Nice for him to get a chance to touch the football. The fullback in the I formation is one of the unsung heroes in a very key position.
Didn't he tell you when you were at Miami he'd never play fullback?
He wanted to be a running back. I don't blame him.
He's turned into one of the best fullback in the country. There goes Stevens Holland. He's got room on the outside. Initially hit at the 16 and forces it down to the 12-yard line. Boy, the running backs today, a big part of the Pitt story.
Well, it really is. They're going to be a big part of it all year long. If you can't stop the Pitt run, you're not going to beat the Pitt Panthers. Especially what I've been impressed with was Stahl, and he allows another dimension. And then you get Derek Kinder back healthy. Pitt could be a very balanced offense.
Last 7 plays all on the ground for the Panthers. 5 of those rushes by McCoy. And here comes McCoy. trying to find a little seam across the right side. He's got it inside the 10. Another first down. It'll be first and goal to go from there.
They're really pounding inside the tackles, and I think that's an important philosophy because it's really weighing on this Bowling Green defense. They've lost some defensive linemen. Very important.
Going right behind Malecki.
Yeah, left guard. Nice pull by Malecki. A really job. Good job. Again, coached by Tony Wise, an outstanding offensive line coach.
So Kavanaugh really going to the ground game now, the offensive coordinator for the Panthers. First and goal to go. They've got it inside the 10. Look at that little stutter step by McCoy. Inside the 5, down to the 4.
Now that's pretty special there. That's pretty special. That's a negative play and made a positive play out of it. Should have been no gain, loss of 2. Still moving the chains, and now second down, go from the 5.
To be able to have the ability to hang on to the ball while you're making a move, getting the handoff from the quarterback and do that, that's just pure talent. Now McCoy, the lone setback. Second and goal from inside the 5. Stahl lobs it up into the corner of the end zone. They're going to go to their true freshman, Jonathan Baldwin, who has 41-inch vertical leap, and he already stands 6'5".
Well, I think Baldwin's going to be a special player, and reminds me a little bit of a Larry Fitzgerald that played here a few years ago. Great player. And I think that Baldwin can be that type player. He doesn't know what to do all the time now. He's still learning. He's going to be a special player.
Right now you're going to probably see him a lot on those goal line situations like that where you just throw up a jump ball. Why not?
Well, exactly right. He's going to win most of those.
11th play of this drive coming up. Third and goal, and now we have a timeout.
This is an important series because it looks like Pitt, and they've dominated this football game, but look at the score. 7-0.
So they'll be facing a third and goal from the 5 when we return to Pittsburgh in a moment. College football from Pittsburgh presented by Allstate on ESPNU. And right now the Panthers leading 7-0, knocking on the door again, facing a third and goal from the 5. The one pass play, an incompletion. What do they do here on 3rd and 5? Stalled, who pass? Across the middle, wide open, touchdown! He is back again, Derek Kinder.
What a great play call by Matt Kavanaugh. Nice little pick in the, I don't guess you could pick, but kind of a little rub off in the end zone there. Really well-designed play and nice execution. Again, really good protection by the offensive line. As Matt Kavanaugh says, it's going to be quick, and he gets it out of his hands. He's accurate. You can see it on that play.
They get the touchdown via the pass, but that drive really predicated by the run.
No doubt about it.
Now for the extra point. Remember, he's 76 for 76 in his career. That is a Pitt record. The previous consecutive record for Pitt, 60 in this proud tradition. But Mr. Perfect is perfect again. Connor Lee tacks on the extra point and makes it 14-0. So the Panthers this time break through the glass wall. Kinder with his first touchdown of the year, and it's 14-0. Welcome back to Heinz Field, where Pitt has plenty to cheer about. Pittsburgh leading now 14-0. Saturday primetime college football continues on ESPNU High Def as the Boston College Eagles face the Kent State Golden Flashes. ESPNU College Football presented by Citi at 7:30 Eastern. Larry Coker and our entire crew here in Pittsburgh. I'm Dave Armstrong, watching Pitt totally dominate this game defensively, as Bowling Green has not been able to get untracked, and now Connor Lee will tee it up as Pitt leads 14-0.
I think the thing you see, we knew both teams had young offensive line. I think you see the Bowling Green offensive line really being exposed at this time. Pitt's offensive line seems to be handling it a little bit better.
A kick, high end over end, taken by Williams at the 6. Williams hit hard at the 20. Move forward to the 26-yard line. Now let's see if Bowling Green can do something offensively. They've really done nothing. You look at their 3 possessions. On the first possession, an interception. The next 2 possessions, 3 and out.
They need to make some first downs and rest their defense. I know that's cliche in coaching, but I think it's true. need to get some momentum and get their defense off the field a little bit and just really kind of get some action back in the game.
They haven't cracked the 50 yet. They have not had one play over on the pitch side of the field. So now they come up with a weird formation to begin things, where they take the entire line way out to the high side of the field. How do you defend this? And a quick hitter will gain 8 yards on the play. So the weirdness works as we get you to Lowell Galindo.
Last season, it was a Macho Harris interception return for a touchdown to get Virginia Tech jump-started against East Carolina. This season, Stephen Virgil picking up the fumble. That is your jump-start. Hokies up 14-0.
Another quick hitter here by Sheehan, who is really left unprotected back there, and he's able to get the first down. The first down for Bowling Green.
Well, we used to call it the yellow swing gate. It's something out of the archives. But Bowling Green's kind of pulling out all the stops now. They're having trouble blocking the Pitt defense. They're trying to create a little bit of uncertainty on that defensive football team.
Yeah, you'll think of Phil Bennett and what he told us yesterday about alignment, the number one key. How do you align against something like that? A little soft. Sheehan is able to get it outside. A nice soft touch there as he's able to get it to Bullock coming out of the backfield.
Well, I think their alignment to that, the Pittsburgh defensive coaches, they have seen that because they've aligned pretty good to it. They've shifted out, and I think that's what Bowling Green wanted to see. Can they line up? And they could.
Now a little more traditional, even though it's the spread offense, a little more traditional spread look from Bowling Green.
Yes, it is.
And a third and five. Given time, pass is completed, and a first down, and across the 50 for the first time today goes Tyrone Pronti.
This was a series that the Bowling Green Falcons needed. They needed to show some spark, some execution, and a little bit of trickery, the swing gate, and now they've made some plays, and this is what they want to see and want to do.
Phil Bennett calling the plays, the defensive coordinator of the Panthers, again coming over from SMU, where he was the head coach, former defensive coordinator at A&M, at LSU, and at Kansas State, where he worked with Bill Snyder. Quick hitter to the outside, and another first down to Pronti.
What you're seeing from Bowling Green now is the quick pass outside. It's somewhat like an old traditional toss sweep, just a quick pass. You're blocking the perimeter, and now you're using the entire field. That's an advantage of the spread offense, spreading the field and make Pitt tackle you in the open field.
They gave him a gain of 9 instead. It's second and 1. And a run this time, and it looks like all of a sudden, here goes Bowling Green. Looking for the end zone, hauled down inside the 10. Big run there for Chris Bullock. First signs of life for Bowling Green.
We've seen now, we haven't seen much of the run at all, but look at this. It's opened up. Big pass rush by the Pitt front. Really nice run. Nice blocking the perimeter and a good run by Bullock.
36-yard run for Bullock. So after not crossing across the 50, here they are, down to the 5, first and goal to go.
First and goal.
And this time it's Turner lining up at quarterback. Turner looking to run. Nothing doing. Got maybe a yard. Scott McKillop in there with a stop.
Coordinator Phil Bennett talked about red zone defense. That's something else that he felt like his defense needed to improve on. And they're going to get a chance to right now.
How about McKillop, coach? Last year, everybody was concerned who's going to replace HB Blades. Right. McKillop really wasn't on anybody's radar screen. No one thought he would be as great as he became, but he became the leading tackler in the country.
I think a little bit like Zach Thomas, formerly with the Miami Dolphins.
So we've got a timeout with 7:59 remaining. Bowling Green now knocking on the door. Welcome you back to Heinz Field. Pittsburgh leading 14-0, but Bowling Green has second and goal from the 5. Tyler Sheehan has been perfect on this drive. 5 for 5 on this drive for 32 yards. And again, though, this time to Barnes. Barnes with a little soft toss, in for the score. Barnes, who is a quarterback in 06, with a touchdown pass.
A lot of misdirection. They line it up shin wide to the wide side of the field. A little misdirection. Faking the sweep to the wide side. And just a nice little delay to the eligible tight end.
And they get it to Jimmy Scheidler for the score. Another one of those wrinkles from the Falcons.
Really frustrating for any defensive coach. Phil Bennett would have called that a win if it held it for the field goal.
And the extra point is tacked on by Vervillo. So Scheidler gets the touchdown. A pass from Freddie Barnes, who was the leading receiver last year for the Falcons.
Well, an outstanding athlete, and surprising throughout history, the outstanding quarterbacks that have also moved to receiver. I remember my old Tulsa days, a Drew Pearson, great receiver for the Dallas Cowboys, was an outstanding quarterback. Those guys can do a lot of things usually, and you saw that out of Freddie Barnes.
They have really three guys like that for the Falcons. I mean, they've got Freddie Barnes who can do that. They also have Anthony Turner, another guy that can do that, and we saw him lined up at quarterback.
Yeah, they're very diverse, and again, I think really trying to really cause Phil Bennett some problems in calling defenses and getting his players lined up.
Coach, it seemed, too, that whole swinging gate offense to start this drive just sent Pitt's defense into a state of confusion.
It really did a little bit. They knew how to line up to it, but it took away some of the aggressiveness. You can tell Pitt's a very tough, physical football team, and they want to play some smash-mouth football. And Bowling Green, that's really not their mantra, so they made it really a little tougher on Pitt and really took some of the momentum away from Pittsburgh Panthers. And
consider this. Bowling Green had done nothing offensively on their first three drives. They didn't have a first down. They threw an interception. They only had 10 yards total offense, and they marched right down the field.
And they had negative plays. You never have negative plays in the spread offense, and they had several negative plays. And again, a tribute to the Pitt defense. A good job by the Bowling Green offense. Greg Brandon shaking it up a little bit.
Revilla to kick things off. Wright's got it at the five. And sandwiched, a shoe goes flying in the air as he is hit at the 20, only a 15-yard return. You look at the point attack, and there's the swinging gate offense.
Well, you've got to be sound against the run, and then you have to be sound against the pass because they have eligible receivers, and I think it's very important. Pitt has seen this formation.
And then the touchdown play to Scheidler, the pass from Freddie Barnes.
A good job by Greg Brandon kind of shaking things up, and the swinging gate seems like it did that. Gave Bowling Green some momentum back.
Last drive for Pitt, mostly on the ground. They start here on their own 20-yard line, first and 10. And again, they go to the ground. And they push the pile forward. It looks like right now this offensive line for Pitt, Coach, starting to manhandle Bowling Green just a little bit.
Well, run blocking is a little bit easier from the standpoint of assignment-wise than pass protection. They feel like they can be good run blockers. And again, Tony Wise is such an outstanding football coach. And I think you see that, not that impressive, but a 3-4 yard gain. And that's going to really wear on the Bowling Green defense as the day goes on. Again, a very hot, humid day in Pittsburgh.
Gain of four there from McCoy. Second and six. Here comes the blitz. Stall, a quick hitter to the outside, and that's incomplete. It was a forward pass, so it's just incomplete. Pass intended out there for McGee.
It seemed like that Stall was trying to beat the blitz with a quick pass and just didn't execute it very well. And I think Bowling Green played it pretty well also.
So here comes another third down situation for Stall. They're 4 of 7 today on third down.
Well, you like to be 50% on third down. If you do that, you're doing pretty well.
Stall feels the pressure, steps up. Now throws off his back foot. Complete! How in the world did he complete that pass to Nate Byam?
Well, again, Byam's made some nice plays. I think that's a very ill-advised throw by Stall. You see he's got a lot of pressure. He kind of throws it up, and that sometimes can go the other way. I'll give Byam the credit on this play. He made this play. Great job adjusting. High point the football. He's been well coached to go get the football. Make your quarterback look good.
One thing we've seen, though, from Stall, he's able to throw in traffic. You talked earlier about how he senses the pressure, but he also can throw in traffic.
Now, he has really good feet.
First down here. First down at the 35. And this time they string it out. McCoy will lose five. Knocked down at the 30, a loss of five as Antonio Smith came up from his cornerback position to make the stop.
Well, Antonio Smith is a good corner. Again, they're running the sweep into the wide, into the short side of the field. Not a lot of room there. A great job by Bowling Green on defense, stringing the play out. No place for McCoy to go.
And now Bowling Green staring at a clock that's winding down near 6 minutes. If they can get a stop here on this possession for Pitt, who knows? Even though it's a half that's pretty much been dominated by the Panthers, they might go in tied at halftime.
I'm sure that's what Bowling Green's looking for.
Second and 15 contact there. And they haven't blown the whistle, so Kinder has a free play. And he's able to get it up to the 39-yard line. Now, what would you do here? You're going to get 5 yards on the penalty, or you can take 8 yards and a down.
I'd probably take 5 yards of the penalty here. I think the thing, too, it's going to be a and quarterback knew it was a free play. Like you said, there wasn't contact made, so nothing to lose. Go ahead and throw it out and take a chance at it. And
I think offside, 90, the defense, 5-yard penalty, second down.
And they do what you would have done.
Yeah, and they're going to get the down over again, which I think is why they wanted to do it. The yardage was somewhat the same.
Yeah, instead of facing a third and six, now you're faced with a seven and just outside 10 yards to go. So they got the five back. They lost on that run by McCoy. And alternately, if you're Pitt, you're thinking, all right, let's put the hammer down and get one more score and a little separation going into the locker room. Stall, given time, dumps it off down to the 39-yard line. A pass completed there to Turner. And Turner with a gain of four.
Really, really impressed with the poise that Stall has. Really sets in, moves his feet well, moves around, and puts the ball in the hands of his playmakers. I think he's really been impressive thus far in this football game. And I think Matt Cavanaugh is doing a good job helping build his confidence as the game goes on. But again, as you said, 14-7 football game. This is a big series for the Bowling Green defense.
And a big play right here, third and five. Pitt needs the 45-yard line for the first down. Stall. And quick hitter to Turner on the outside, and he wasn't quite turned around to make the grab.
No, the timing wasn't there, and I think Turner, again, needs to really come out of his break. He had a nice route. He was open, but you got to get out of your break and give your quarterback a target. Timing just wasn't there.
Turner, once he turned, the ball was already there, and he really didn't find it.
Well, what happened? Stall rushed his throw a little bit because he had some pressure. Rather than take the sack, he got the ball out of his hand, which is a smart play on his part.
Now Dave Brightus, a left-footed kicker. He booms one. Partridge goes over and calls the fair catch at the 14-yard line. And college football action returns to ESPNU later tonight as the Prairie View A&M Panthers meet the Texas Southern Tigers. ESPNU college football tonight at 10:30 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. And let's see if Bowling Green can move the length of the field in under 5 minutes. You look at those first three drives, only 6 yards on 11 plays, including an interception. But then that last drive really confounded Phil Bennett and this Panther defense. They hold the ball out for Bullock, who was able to get across the 15 up to the 16-yard line.
I believe that was a read option by Tyler Sheehan. He could have kept the football, but he saw the crease for Bullock and handed the football off. Probably a good decision on his part. Again, making some positive plays.
Is the spread offense sort of like the new version of the wishbone?
I think it's exactly like that. I think the more powerful it is when you have a great running quarterback.
Sheehan wants to go down the sideline, incomplete. Pass intended over there for Barnes, and he threw it over his head. Well, coming up at halftime on SportsCenter U with Lowell Galindo, LSU playing a little earlier today because of the storm coming in, and they're rolling against Appalachian State. Georgia debuts as number one for the first time ever. And Tim Tebow, he starts the campaign, got to be the odds-on favorite to win two straight.
He does. Archie Griffin, the only one to win two, and it's really a challenge for Tebow.
Certainly had that opportunity. A big third down play here. Sheehan given time. Now the pocket collapses. The ball is tipped at the line and incomplete.
I really like the pressure that the Pitt defense is putting on Sheehan, but also the coverage is outstanding because he's holding the football, and he doesn't do that in the spread offense. I'm really impressed with the rush, but also with the Pitt coverage.
Yeah, the cover, that was a coverage sack, wasn't it?
Yeah,
I've heard that. But a coverage tip, anyway.
Yeah, they call that a hurry and a tip, and that's not as good as a sack, but it's close. It's an incompletion, and now they're in a punting situation.
And again, plenty of time on the clock for Pitt to come down and score.
No question.
And they'll get good field position, you would think. Everybody backing off. The ball actually bounced backward, back over the 50-yard line. You talk about excellent field position. Pitt will have it in Bowling Green territory.
Well, they will. That's a good bounce for Pitt. They didn't get the good bounce on the long punt, but they got the good bounce on that one. Great field position, a lot of time, plus they have timeouts.
And we talked about Tebowing, one of those guys that you look for the Heisman. How about some of the guys you're looking to this year on your watch list as to who you think might have a great shot?
Well, I think Wells from Ohio State, they're probably going to have a great year. I think he's an outstanding back. He's one certainly that you look at. But there are several. It's really a wide open race right now, but I think it's going to be an exciting season to see who steps up.
I say look out for Chase Daniel at Missouri. Yeah. The Tigers are set up for a good year. There's a little bit of a horse collar. Now the ball comes loose, and Bowling Green has got it. A fumble by McCoy, and Bowling Green able to come up with it. Dozier, the middle linebacker, has the ball.
Good job. The ball is just ripped out. I don't know if LaShawn ever secured the football, but a good job by the Bowling Green defense. And again, you're in traffic. Most fumbles are going to occur right in that middle area.
Remember, there's a new rule about horse collaring, but it doesn't apply to running backs running inside the tackles.
Running backs or quarterbacks.
Or quarterback. So that new rule doesn't apply there. Bowling Green gets it on the turnover. The turnovers are even now. An interception for Pitt and the fumble there. And the pass completed here to Partridge down to the 34-yard line. A 17-yard play.
Football is so much momentum and attitude. And you can see now Bowling Green's starting to feel a little better about themselves, really ready to get a little momentum and making some plays. That's how you get momentum, is make plays, and they're doing that now.
And turnovers so costly to Pitt a year ago. They were minus six in the turnover department, and now a timeout is called.
You need to get the down box set to first down. Officials timeout.
The down box wasn't quite set over there. And that's certainly something you want to take care of. I did the fifth down game at Missouri between the Buffaloes and the Tigers.
Yeah, I was in the old Big 8 conference at the time. Yeah. We watched that quite a few times when I was in Oklahoma.
I'm still running back the plays in my head. Now Colorado got five plays at the end of that game. Another pass deflected at the line. This time it's Romeus.
Well, we've got to get hands down. That's the way we used to coach it. Get their hands down. Get their hands down. But really a nice job by Romeus with the hands up. And he's well coached. Look at his timing. His timing. It's 1, 2, 3, hands up. Ball's batted down. Really a nice job.
You talk about coaching them to get their hands down. How do they do that?
Well, again, I think it's pretty much timing because it's 1, 2, 3, and usually the hands. That's the way it times out.
Second and 10 now. And it's Barnes back at quarterback looking to run. And he's found a hole. Barnes able to get the first down down to the 23-yard line.
Has that turnover been costly again against Bowling Green position? Again, they've been dominated, but yet they're still in this football game. They're really starting, as I said earlier, starting to get some momentum.
And again, this was, for the most part, a half dominated by the Panthers, but not on the scoreboard. And now Bowling Green, with under 3 minutes to go in the half, they have another chance. And again, it's Barnes throwing on the run, and the pass is caught. Reaching for the end zone, and just shy of it is Bullock. Again, the creative nature of the Falcons offensively as Barnes completes it to Bullock for 22 yards.
I think you can see that Barnes has completed a little underneath pass a couple of times and done well with it. This time he goes to the intermediate pass, wide open, good execution.
Now first and goal from the one. Sheehan trying the quarterback sneak. Looked like the ball came loose. Pitt says they have it.
Second down.
Sheehan able to hang on to the ball. They lost maybe a half yard there.
That play is a simple play, a quarterback sneak, except you don't work on it very much. You don't run your quarterback into the line of scrimmage and get the big pileups that often. And in coaching defense, when a quarterback has the football, you know that he doesn't get hit much in practice, so you try to get the ball stripped and take it away from him.
A good point. Now second and goal. And again, they've got Barnes back in there, quarterback from the shotgun. Turner. Turner backs up to throw into the end zone, and it's incomplete. There is a flag down on the play.
Holding, 61 on the offense. 10-yard penalty, second down.
That's the freshman center, Ben Boychuk.
What a tough penalty for Bowling Green. Watch the center, 61, Boychuk. Right, yes, an obvious call. Wrapped him around the neck. Good call by the official. Again, a costly penalty for Bowling Green.
Sure is, because now instead of having it third and goal at the one, they back him up. Second and goal, but way back to the 11.
It's a little more difficult now, your offensive calls.
Three penalties against Bowling Green. No penalties against Pitt today.
You got Sheehan back at quarterback now. Probably going to be a pass.
Sheehan looking into the flat. He's got his receiver wide open. That's Pronte, who is promptly hit out of bounds. Now third and goal inside the three.
Well, an outstanding route and good execution by the Bowling Green offense. Pronte and Sheehan. Good timing, good protection up front.
Now timeout taken here by Sheehan and Bowling Green. They have one timeout remaining now with 1:17 remaining. So what's up the sleeve of the coaching staff of the Falcons here on a third and goal situation? I mean, this has got to be a scary team to try to defend because you just don't know what's coming at you. They have so many different formations and variations to what they do.
Well, there's no doubt about it. And the thing that you have is there's so much they can do. They spread the field. They can run the ball some. And I think you saw a great tackle by Chappelle, or that would have been a touchdown.
Right now you see the defensive coordinator, Phil Bennett. Now they huddle offensively for Bowling Green. As you look at things here, Coach, it's one of these situations where if you're Bowling Green, I mean, this is now sort of a game situation for them. Here they are, down a touchdown. They punch it across here. They can erase all the memories of what happened as far as the loss of yards, the interception, the fact that they didn't get anything going. They can cure all that with one play here.
They've got amnesia. They score a touchdown here.
Absolutely. Third and goal from the two. Sheehan rolling out to the right, throwing back to the left, wide open, touchdown! What a play call again and again. It's Scheidler, his second touchdown grab of the game.
I've seen that play a lot of times from the old Paul Pasqualoni Syracuse teams. Great execution, delay, and it's really, you see it, you cover it, watch it. But again, it's very difficult to have the discipline to stay in position. Great call by Bowling Green, great execution.
On paper, Pitt dominating this game. You look at the stats at halftime, and they're going to be decidedly in the Panthers' favor. But now Scheidler with his second touchdown reception, this one officially from 3 yards out.
Again, look at this misdirection. Again, it's a sprint. They're rolling the pocket. They've done this some today a couple of times. Roll the pocket, and now stop and throw back. Tight end comes all the way across the field. A little bit of a delay. Good execution.
Boy, that's a great catch, too, by Scheidler. Scheidler, by the way, discovered a distant relative. He came into practice last year and he noticed a Jay Scheidler, but listed at only 200 pounds. And he was like, wait a minute, I weigh about 240. What happened to all those pounds? Well, they found out there was another guy on the roster named Josh Scheidler. So they started to think, and Scheidler isn't a real common name. And they started to examine, neither one had met the other. And they started to examine that, you know what, they indeed were distant cousins. They had never met each other before. Now they room together. Unfortunately, Josh is out with an ACL, a linebacker, a promising linebacker for Bowling Green, who once played for Valparaiso.
Well, I hope they're the same name. I hope they like each other. That's key. Rooming together, I guess they do.
Well, now you think, does Pitt have time to respond here with 1-11? They've got to be a little bit shell-shocked right now. And you think of that turnover by LaShawn McCoy when it looked like instead of going up 14-7, Pitt, the way they were moving the ball, who knows, they could have a 2-touchdown lead at halftime. Instead, that turnover again, and you don't have to remind Wanstead about turnovers and how costly they are, but that turnover is so costly here today.
Well, that's huge, and they don't want to make a mistake again. They've got time, but they need to execute and not make a mistake. They don't want to give Bowling Green any more points.
Short kick. And I wonder about this play, because now you've handed Pitt great field position.
Well, that changes the philosophy. If I'm Matt Kavanaugh now, I'm going to attack these guys because you've got a short field now. Maybe get in position for a field goal. I'm questioning that a little bit also.
So with 1:25 remaining, you have handed Pitt just 55 yards to go to the end zone and only about 25 yards to go to get into field goal range.
Plus they have timeouts.
They have two timeouts remaining. Well, you could see Stahl just hanging in there, waiting to the last second to let that one go.
He had pressure from the corner, and really nice job on his part. He held it till the last moment. He didn't get panicked. He didn't rush it. He set in and made the play. He didn't make the throw, but he did all he could do.
Second down, 10. The ball's at the 45.
Second and 10 from the shotgun. Stahl throws it outside. The pass is complete for a first down. Pass completed to Kinder. So they'll stop the clock to move the chains.
That was a big time throw. And really nice execution. Pretty good coverage, but again, good powerful throw by Stahl. Nice route, nice catch.
Hurry up offense for the Panthers. Oops, movement. First penalty against Pitt today.
False start. 56 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
That's the right tackle, Joe Thomas. And back it up to midfield to the 50-yard line.
Well, now within that two-minute parameter for the first half, it does affect the clock a little bit.
Comes pressure again. Pitt's line does a good job in handling it, and the pass is right on target. Pass is caught by McGee for a first down, and they're close to field goal range down to the 32.
Well, they are, and that's really nice execution. Again, the young Pitt offensive line, a good job. And Stahl, really nice feet, sets up and throws a nice, soft, catchable football right where it had to be thrown out in the flat.
We officially mark him out at the 33, a 17-yard gain. Last year, Connor Lee's longest field goal was 48 yards. Quick hitter to the outside, and again, it's McGee. He goes out of bounds to stop the clock. Now they are in field goal range as he gets it down to the 29.
They're about a 47-yarder right now.
So now you want more if you're Dave Wanstead, yeah, and Matt Kavanaugh.
Exactly right. Let's go score a touchdown. I think that'd really, really be an uplift for your team, really demoralizing for the Bowling Green team. Again, momentum, momentum, momentum. Let's get the momentum. Go attack. Timeouts and 45 seconds left.
Second and 6. Stahl, again, that line gives him time. McCoy shakes a tackle. Moves it down to the 20-yard line. Again, another first down. They'll stop the clock to move the chains. And a timeout taken here by Coach Wanstead.
That's good clock management because, you know, they do have timeouts left.
So they take their second timeout of the half. McCoy coming out of the backfield there. By the way, Stoll on this drive is 4 for 4.
He's looked very impressive. He's done a nice job. He's moved around some. And again, I'm so impressed by his accuracy. Matt Cavanaugh stressed that, and you can see it the way he's executing. Very, very accurate passer.
And again, I question the logic of that last kickoff by Bowling Green to allow Pitt this field position. You know, if they'd have kicked it deep and started Pitt back on their 20, who knows? Pitt might have just said, let's get into the locker room with a score tied.
Well, that's always for a head coach and a coordinator, that's always a tough call because, boy, if we make a mistake down here,
yes,
we're going to give them points. But now you're at midfield, basically. Hey, let's attack. Let's go for these guys.
Yeah, I think it just changed the entire complexion of the way Pitt was going to attack this drive.
I don't think it really is. I think also you can see here, you expect to get points if you're the Pitt Panthers here, somehow, some way.
Absolutely. So at the 20-yard line, a first down. Still one timeout remaining. 36 seconds remaining in the half. Stoll, again, given time. This one batted down at the line and incomplete. Good play defensively in the middle of there. And again, that's Dozier right in the middle of things.
Well, really nice design by the Pitt offense. They had five wide receivers. They cleared everybody out, came underneath with the back, and again, just a nice job with Dozier batting the football down. We've seen several of those today from both sides, Pitt and Bowling Green.
Second and 10. They try to run a draw play to Stevens Howling, and it doesn't get the desired effect for Pitt. Bowling Green does a good job of staying home. So now they're saving that timeout, and now it looks like they're going to let the clock run down and go for the field goal. Crowd doesn't like it. Connor Lee, one of the most accurate kickers in the country, not just the Big East. This was from earlier today. This from 56 yards out.
Well, I was a little surprised earlier in the game that they punted, and he had a 52-yard attempt earlier in the game, and they didn't attempt a field goal there. Again, I don't think the wind or anything's a factor. But here, I'm a little surprised they didn't at least take one shot toward the end zone and save that timeout for the field goal.
I think the crowd here a little surprised, too, and they're letting Pitt have it. They have been accused of having a conservative nature over the last few years. Well, here it's going to be Connor Lee to try to give Pitt the lead going into the locker room. Tied at 14 now. They're going to mark it down at the 26-yard line, a 36-yard attempt. Last year, Lee was 18 of 22 on field goal attempts. He's only missed 6 in his career.
He's 83%. He's the best in the Big East, percentage-wise.
The snap and the hold are good, and so too is the kick. So Connor Lee able to give Pitt the lead going into the locker room at halftime, but you've got to feel like right now Bowling Green is probably smiling the widest as they head to the locker rooms.
I think they are smiling a little bit widely. I think they are disappointed in that last series. I think, like we talked about with the short kick, I think they wanted to go in 14-14. But I think 17-14 is a good half for them. In Pittsburgh, I think they're probably a little disappointed. I think they're glad to get the points. But I think they wanted the touchdowns. They don't like the 14 points that Bowling Green has. You see a little bit in their body language. They got to regroup and come out and attack Bowling Green in the second half.
It'll be interesting to see, too, what changes Pitt makes defensively, because the last few drives for Bowling Green, they have been extremely successful. Pitt looks like they dominated this game, but here we are at halftime, and it's just 17-14 Panthers as we get you to Lowell Galindo and Mike Gottfried with SportsCenter U. ESPNU is now available in high definition. To get the great action on ESPNU in high def, contact your local cable operator or satellite provider. ESPNU HD, the big picture in college sports. You come across the 6th Street Bridge and on into this beautiful complex here. And how about the beautiful LeSean McCoy?
What a great start in the football game. Again, the turnover here was key. The fumble, big play for Bowling Green, allowed Bowling Green to get back in this football game.
couple of touchdown passes to Jimmy Scheidler, both from 3 yards out. So the good and the bad of McCoy, he rushes for 40 yards. He rushed 16 times. He did have that touchdown, but also that big fumble that really created a momentum switch in this first half.
Well, it really did. It's a big momentum switch. And I think if McCoy, again, I think he just needs to get his head up and come back. And he's right on track for what Dave Wanstead wants from the standpoint of 30 carries. He had 16 carries. Mm-hmm. He'll get the 14, 15 carries the second half, protect the football. He'll make some things happen. He's too good a football player not to.
And then one of the guys that we really didn't talk about, I mean, because when you looked at his numbers historically, he really wasn't much of a factor offensively. More they went to Freddie Barnes or Corey Partridge. Instead, it was Jimmy Scheidler. Jimmy Scheidler with two touchdown grabs.
Now, it's a team game, and it doesn't matter. They all count, and I know Bowling Green's really happy to have Jimmy Scheidler today.
I think it's going to be very interesting here, Coach, as we see this second half kickoff, and it's a short kick down to the 19-yard line. Barnes able to pick it up there and bring it up to the 34-yard line. Now, what adjustments did Phil Bennett make in that locker room at halftime to try to stop Bowling Green, an offense that really got going in that second quarter?
Bowling Green's offense started the game trying to create mismatches. They couldn't do that. Pitt matched up well. They were too physical for Bowling Green. Then went to a little bit of trickery, a little bit of misdirection. I think Pitt has to get their aggressiveness back on defense. They can't be back on their heels waiting for trick plays.
When you look at the difference by quarters, as we have a first down play here, 6 yards in the first quarter for Bowling Green, 137 in the second quarter. They were able to really turn it around. Now they give it to Bullock, who gets nothing along the right side. Stopped right at the line of scrimmage, might have fallen forward for a yard.
Jimmy Johnson always talked about in preparing a defense, you prepare for what they're going to beat you with. And now you have some time with the trickery stuff, but you've got to stop their bread and butter, what they're going to try to play and beat you with. And that's what Pitt needs to do this second half.
Officially a gain of two, second and eight. Sheehan straight back, wide open, his receiver Marcus Parks, who was left all by his lonesome, and enough for the first down. They'll move the chains as he's knocked out at the 43. Actually, just shy of the first down marker. He stepped out 1 yard shy.
He got a bad mistake. I think you can make the first down, but I think this is really a frustrating game for the Pitt defense, and especially a linebacker like McKillop. He's a physical player, a tackler, and not that many opportunities in a game like this.
Why didn't Parks get one more yard? 2 of 6, Bowling Green on third down. Sheehan with the option. He'll get the first down here as Bullock bowls his way close to midfield. Enough for the first down. They'll mark him out at the 46.
You're seeing a lot of offense out of this Bowling Green team. That was basically just the old lead option, like Houston used to run out of the Veer offense. And a lot of misdirection, a lot of spread the field. Again, I think Bowling Green would like to be able to mix in some runs in this second half.
Just one more thing to add confusion for Phil Bennett and his defense. So first down here. Sheehan, quick hitter as he's able to find Partridge. And Partridge, good hands there right at midfield.
See, the difference you see in this drive than the drive that started the game, the negative plays. This drive now, second down and five. It's a good rhythm for the Bowling Green offense. That's the type of offense they want to play. They'll go some shots downfield, but they want the high percentage possession passing.
A lot of Pitt fans thought this was going to be a cakewalk. Oh, nothing like that. And certainly the Pitt players and their coaches knew it wasn't. They knew the strength of Bowling Green. Good coverage that time. They try to get it to Turner on a quick hitter across the middle. And there for Pitt defensively, Aaron Berry was right there again.
Well, Aaron Berry is their shutdown corner. Really a good design by Bowling Green. There's a Pittsburgh blitz and there's one-on-one coverage. But again, just good coverage by Aaron Berry.
So now third down. Third and a long five. They need to get it down to the 44-yard line for the first down. I call it third and six. That's what it is. Sheehan given time now. Throwing under pressure. A fumble after the catch by Barnes, but he had a teammate right there to jump on the ball. Partridge was there to save the day. And now a player is down for Pitt. That player is Adam Gunn, one of the linebackers for the Panthers. One of the senior linebackers, one of the leaders on this defense.
Pitt's linebackers are very good, but they're not deep. They have to have some young players that really step up, the three starting linebackers, Gunn being one of those. But, again, the depth behind them is not that good.
To show you how they're not so deep, as we look at this play once again, watch Gunn, number 8. Oh, a helmet to helmet. He collided with his own teammate. Well, that's a real bell ringer.
Yeah, that's an ugly contact there, because head down a little bit, and those are always scary.
Boy, he ran right into his teammate McKillop. They're side by side all the time, but now Gunn running into McKillop. And certainly Dave Wonsett and this Pitt team concerned as Adam Gunn lays down on the field. We'll hope for the best, and we'll be back in a moment. We have some good news to report from Pittsburgh. Yes. Adam Gunn walked off the field under his own power, now being looked at over on the sideline. He is replaced now by Nate Nix in the lineup. Nix, just a sophomore out of Jefferson Hills, Pennsylvania. So the good news, though, Gunn walking off under his own power. Sheehan leaps over the pile in the middle on this first down play and gets it down to the 40-yard line. Excuse me, that's Turner again. It's hard to tell who's who at quarterback. They've used three different guys back there at quarterback, and you never know which one it's going to be.
That's a problem that Phil Bennett and his defense has also, because they can do different things. Some guys can run better, some can pass better. And you have some of these guys like Barnes can throw and run.
You know, Coach told us yesterday that one of his main concerns is alignment. I need to make sure on my alignment to see who's back there at quarterback. And right now it is Turner again. And again, Turner trying to run straight ahead. And this outlines what you were just saying, Coach, that they need to establish more of a running game here in the second half.
They have. It's not necessarily with a running back. It's that whoever they play at that running back becomes the quarterback. He's the run. They run an unbalanced formation. They've got 5 wide receivers. They've got 4 to the field, 1 to the boundary, and a single back being the quarterback, as you can see in this formation.
Well, faced a 3rd and short here. And again, it is Turner at quarterback. He's going to run to the right side, slips a tackle, and has the first down. Well, he was able to slip out of the grasp of a would-be tackler. It looks like DeSico just couldn't quite hang on, and Turner gets the first down.
Really great leverage, great speed by DeSico, but just did not make the tackle. And that's one thing that Phil Bennett emphasized, that they're going to tackle every day, and I know that they do. He'll be disappointed. That'll be a missed tackle that DeSico will hate to see on film session tomorrow.
So a first down here. They get the ball inside the 30. Sheehan back in at quarterback. He lost up a pass that was wobbling. He might have been hit a little bit as he threw, and that's incomplete.
Again, good pressure by the Pitt defensive front, because he was pressured. I don't know, the ball might have been tipped or might have just grazed his arm, but yeah, not a sack, but would be called a hurry. They'll show that as a hurry in the film session.
2nd and 10.
It's been an impressive drive for Bowling Green to start the second half.
Yeah, this is their 11th play of this drive. Not impressive there, though. Chris Bullock has stood up right at the line. Impressive, I guess you'd have to say, from a defensive standpoint. And again, it's the converted wide receiver, Austin Ransom.
Well, again, really nice play by Ransom. It had a little bit better cut if he'd gone the other direction. It's easy to see from up here, sometimes not quite as easy down the field, but really nice play by Ransom.
Ransom was working in the spring as a safety. Then he moved back to wide receiver in the fall. Just a week ago, they made him a linebacker.
You don't see that very often.
And he started today at linebacker. 3rd and long. And movement. Another penalty against the Falcons.
False start on the offense. 5-yard penalty. 3rd down.
Now they're shoving themselves out of field goal range.
Well, they really are. This is nice for Pittsburgh. They've got to really contain this field position and really hold, maybe hold them to a punt here, because you're right, they're backing themselves up out of field goal range.
Vervillo, a 49-yarder last year. So he's got good range, but now he's past 50.
A 52-yarder from here.
Sheehan is sacked. Jabal Sheard. Huge move on the outside, and another sack of Sheehan.
Watch this swim move by Jabal, number 97. Great job. And I don't believe Sheehan ever really saw him. I think it really came out of the blind side, and really a great play, huge play for the Pitt defense.
You think Bowling Green had it down inside the 30-yard line, first down, and on two straight plays, they are backed up all the way back to the 45 and now forced to punt.
Turnovers and negative plays. Negative plays will destroy you.
Aaron Berry waving for the fair catch. Remember earlier, he had trouble with the sun, not that time. He is able to catch it at the 9-yard line. So Pitt will come out offensively for the first time, leading 17-14. 9:40 left here in the third quarter. Coming up from Heinz Field, more action as LaShawn McCoy goes back on offense. Welcome back to Pittsburgh, where Coach Coker's ride has arrived. Not the boat, Coach, the bike on the boat. Pittsburgh leading 17-14, LaShawn McCoy. And Frank Gore, what's the comparison that you see?
Well, Frank Gore, great running back we had in Miami, now the 49ers. Vision, I think, is a big thing that I see with Frank Gore. Very strong in the lower body, very powerful. Able to make cut and run through arm tackles. You see both these players able to do that. And he can make somebody miss. You know, a good running back is a running back that can take a 2-yard loss and make a 4-yard gain out of it. Frank Gore was that way, and so is LaShawn McCoy.
So now McCoy, I'm sure, starting this drive with a purpose, because the last drive that he touched the ball, he fumbled the ball. So now he's got to have a short-term memory, but also now kick it into another gear.
Exactly right. He's got to have some amnesia, forget about it, press on.
First down for Pitt at their own 9-yard line. Stall back to pass, and he finds a wide open Byam, and Byam hit hard, but looks like he's got a first down up to the 21.
Yeah, really nice quickness with the release on Stall, and as Matt Cavanaugh says, he gets rid of the ball, he gets through his reads quickly, and gets rid of the football, and you can see that on that play in the flat.
12-yard gain there, and by the way, Stall has thrown to 6 different receivers today.
You really like that if you're an offensive coordinator, and you really like it also if you're those receivers. And something like when you're a receiver, you want to catch the football.
Now McCoy. There's that elusiveness you were talking about as he gets it up to the 28-yard line as we get you into the studio for another update with Lowell Galindo.
Well, guys, do not let the 33-point lead deceive you. Ohio State fans are concerned. Chris Beanie Wells carted away from the sidelines after an injury to his right leg. He's getting checked out, 111 yards, and Ohio State is rolling.
Boy, you could see Wells holding on to that foot. We certainly hope for his case and for the Buckeyes that's nothing serious.
No question. You'd hate for any player to get injured, but certainly a great player like Wells.
Bowling Green, first time out of the half.
And Bowling Green wasn't set up. They weren't aligned defensively and forced to take a timeout here. It's their first time out of the half. And they're going to take a short timeout here. They just weren't aligned right, so it's 17-14 Pitt. Hey, Saturday primetime college football continues on ESPNU HD as the Boston College Eagles take on the Kent State Golden Flashes. ESPNU college football presented by Citi at 7:30 Eastern tonight. For more information, always log on to ESPNU.com. Kent State goes into that game with one of the top running backs in Eugene Jarvis, a man who rushed for 1,669 yards in his career. And Boston College will have a new look this year.
They have a new look. They've lost a great quarterback in Matt Ryan.
Second and three. See what Boston College is able to do. Second and three here for Pitt. little trickery in the backfield, but Bowling Green stood their ground. They weren't fooled at all, and McCoy is stopped for no gain.
One thing about the running game, you can't allow penetration. And that time, Bowling Green did a great job penetrating in the backfield. And once you get LaShawn McCoy before he gets started, that's an advantage for your defense.
Now they bring in the fullback, Conridge Collins, facing a third and a long 2 yards. We'll call it third and three. They need to get the ball up to the 31, just past the 31-yard line for the first down. Kinder comes in motion. They're going to throw. And they throw out to the flat to Collins, and he can't hang on. Is that a catch and a fumble? Wanstad is saying that was never a catch, and now the officials are going to confer. I don't think it was a catch.
I think it was an incompletion. I don't think he ever caught the football, never controlled it.
The ruling on the field is an incomplete pass.
I think that's right.
That's a good call. It was an incomplete pass.
And again, every play is reviewable, and every play is reviewed, and I think this one will stand. It's hard to see when he tucked it there whether he actually ever had control. You know, this will be a better look. I don't think he ever had control.
No, never had control of the football. And I think the thing you saw with Bill Stahl there, he really didn't set his feet. He was kind of sliding against pressure and a little off balance and really didn't get a good throw in the flat to Conridge Collins.
So forced to punt again. Here's Brightus. Short kick. And coming up to get it, Partridge. So pretty good field position here for Bowling Green as they'll start at their own 42-yard line. An 8-yard return from the home of Hannes Wagner and Roberto Clemente. The Pirates playing the Brewers tonight if you can get to Pittsburgh. We'll see if Pitt can get going on defense. Bowling Green has the ball. College football presented by Allstate on ESPNU. Pitt leading 17-14. But it's Bowling Green with the ball and good field position at their own 41-yard line. Sheehan with a quick hitter to the outside. Incomplete, intended for Bullock off his fingertips. And for everything that you need to know about college sports, there is one great source, the best source. It's ESPNU.com. Anything you want to know about college sports, it's there. Larry Coker has that bookmarked on his laptop. He goes there for everything, including almost recipes. I mean, they have everything. What you can cook for dinner? No, not that. But they have anything else about college sports. ESPNU.com, great source. Good coverage on the outside by Barry as Parks makes the ball. No extra yards after the catch. He has stopped right at the 47-yard line. It's going to bring up a third and four.
That's an excellent tackle by Barry, and that's what Phil Bennett would like to see, that type of tackling. And really good pursuit chasing the football.
And it looked like Barry came up lame a little bit. The trainers come out on the field.
That's not a good sign, especially against a spread offense with 4 and 5 wide receivers.
Barry's shaking off the trainers. He didn't even want to look in their direction.
He'll have to come out of play. He'll have to come out off the field for one play, or Pitt will have to use a timeout, which I don't think they will do that. They'll take him out for a play and look at him and see if he's healthy. If he comes back in, you might well see Bowling Green test him and send somebody down the field. Let's see if he's healthy.
Well, he's very upset as he comes off the field. I think he's upset that they sent the trainers out there more than anything else.
Well, you know, you're a player. You don't want to leave the field. That's part of being a football player. You don't want to leave the field. And, again, this Pittsburgh defense has a lot of pride. They're very competitive and very tough kids. Mm-hmm. And they like to stay out and play.
When you talk about 50% ratio on third down, that's right where Bowling Green is today, 5 for 10.
You'll be one of the tops in the nation if you do that throughout the year.
Sheehan steps up. He is hit. Now let's see where they mark the ball, because where he was hit was beyond the yards he needs, but he fell forward, and this is going to be very close. I still think he is maybe the length of a football shy of the first down. We'll have to mark.
I believe he is short.
They're going to bring the chains out to take a look. Now, we're just eyeballing it from up here, but I believe it's just a little bit short.
I think it's short also. And, Dave, you make the call. Fourth down, you're an underdog. You're on the road.
Go.
Midfield.
Go.
Oh, okay.
I'm going. What would you do?
Well, I'm going to wait and see.
You're the offensive coordinator.
I'm, I'm going to wait and see. Don't ask me those tough questions.
All right. See, I told you it's a little bit short. Yeah. About the length of the football.
I think they'll probably punt.
Really?
Well, because they're playing pretty well right now. They've kind of balanced the game up a little bit.
I think they're going for it. They're going to go for it. All right. So this is a little gamble as far as you're concerned.
Yeah, well, no. It's and you made the call, so we're going to check you out here.
Oh, boy. My job is on the line here as offensive coordinator.
Exactly right.
All right. Let's see if I made the right call. On the option, they've got the first down. Never a doubt.
You made a great call. Again, that is a good call because you're on the road, you're an underdog, you're behind. Good execution.
Oh, so now you're with me.
I'm with you now because it worked. I wasn't a coordinator now. I'm a head coach now.
See,
it worked.
Now you know what fans have done to you as a coach your whole life.
Yeah, I mean, that's exactly right. They should have. Yeah. They should have.
So a first down here. Gutsy call by Bowling Green. And they're inside pit territory down to the 47. Sheehan lobs it up. Again, it's Bullock. Nice cutback, and Bullock gets it inside the 40.
They're really, really frustrating the pit defense right now because they're making positive plays, and now they're in the second down and two. And really, it's really a lot of mixture of things. A nice little soft pass, and blocking the perimeter, and making the Pitt defense run on a hot day.
Nice gain there of 8. Second and 2. Sheehan again looks right, comes back left. That's the touchdown play to Scheidler. This time it goes for big yards inside the 20 down to the 16.
Just a little misdirection delay. Again, they're really trying to take the aggressiveness of the Pitt defense away. They're doing a good job of that. I think what we talked about early in the first half, the Bowling Green defense needed some rest. I think the Pitt defense needs some rest now. When the Pitt offense comes back out, they need to do a good job.
Scheidler looks like he got banged up a little bit. He has to come over to the sideline. A gain of 22 on that play. Sheehan again given time, and the pass is caught, goes directly out of bounds. Good pass catch there on the outside. That pass is caught by Wright.
You can see now these mismatches are working in Bowling Green's favor. The key thing you said, Dave, was he had time. He did have time. He made a nice throw and really good execution out of bounds. And now it's look at the down and distance. Very makeable now. Very makeable situation.
Gain of 4, second and 6. 5 receivers are split out for the Falcons on this spread. Sheehan, quick hitter across the middle. He gets it to Bullock, who is leaning forward, stretching for that first down. I think he's got it.
A problem you have on defense is that you've got to have somebody at your linebacking core that can bump out and cover a little receiver. I can call it a hybrid type guy. A guy that's kind of a defensive back and also kind of a linebacker. That player is kind of hard to find sometimes.
Well, they're going to measure again and bring out the chains and see. Now, our angle on this isn't nearly as good as it was at the 50, so I'm not even going to hazard a guess here. You know what? I will hazard a guess. I'll say he made it.
Whoa.
That's why I shouldn't have hazarded a guess. He's a few inches shy of the mark, so it's third and literally inches. Look at the drive for Bowling Green. 52 yards and 8 plays. One fourth down play right at midfield that kept the drive going. Facing a third and inches here. And now they're going to bring in Turner. He'll line up at the quarterback position. And he's done this before. For the most part, he's run. He can throw it, though. Going to try to run it here, and he runs into the end zone for the touchdown. And for the first time today, the Falcons have the lead.
What a great drive by Bowling Green. A great job at halftime, making adjustments and getting their team involved and back in the game, and that's really just a super job by the Bowling Green coaching staff, and good execution on this drive in this third quarter by the Bowling Green offense.
They have co-offensive coordinators Matt Campbell and Troy Rothenbuehler. One calls the run game, one calls the pass game. Well, they have met somewhere and come up with a game plan since that awful first quarter where they had only 6 yards. Now a block extra point. So that is no good from Vervillo, but it still has Bowling Green in front. But those two offensive coordinators have really righted the ship here. The touchdown run here for Turner.
Nice block on the pull by the left guard and a good finish by Turner.
But instead of a four-point lead, the lead only a field goal, as we get you back to Lowell Galindo with an update.
Terrell Pryor has his first touchdown as a Buckeye, a 19-yard touchdown run, and they are erecting a bronze statue of Terrell Pryor outside the shoe as we speak.
It's funny stuff as Ohio State leading 40 to nothing now, looking impressive.
Yeah, they're going to be a very impressive football team. Hopefully Chris Wells is not injured severely.
You look at Bowling Green and what they have done against non-BCS teams, and Bowling Green with 9 wins over BCS teams. 9 wins. They've done an outstanding job, including one last year where they won at Minnesota in overtime.
Well, what you don't realize is they're a good football team. They're picked to win the Eastern half of the MAC conference, a very, very good conference. And I don't want to overstate it, but they're a good team. You're going to have to play well to beat them. And, again, advantage to Pitt right now, but it's a tough challenge.
And, in fact, today on ESPN College Game Day, Kirk Herbstreit picked Bowling Green to win this game.
Well, that's exactly right. I don't know what he saw. I don't know what he saw. Maybe he'd be an Ohio guy, I think.
Whatever it was, he's right so far. But Pittsburgh gets the ball now and still all kinds of time. This ball is driven all the way back to the goal line, right from his own goal line, across the 20, a 23-yard return. Don't forget, coming up after our game, SportsCenter U, and then after that on ESPNU HD, it's the Delaware Blue Hens taking on the Terrapins of Maryland. ESPNU College Football presented by Allstate at 3:45 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. With Larry Coker, former head coach of the Miami Hurricane, the national champion Hurricane. I'm Dave Armstrong, as Pitt now behind for the first time. And not much room to run up the middle. Boy, I'll tell you what, they said stop the run, and the Falcons have done a pretty good job of that up the middle.
They've adjusted to Pitt bouncing the ball outside and going down the boundary. They've contained it much, much better, chasing the ball well. You know, they've had practice speed all fall camp. Now they're into game speed. They've adjusted to Pitt's game speed.
Stahl facing a second down and 8 yards to go. Time of possession this quarter heavily favors Bowling Green. They've had the ball for better than 9 minutes this quarter. Play action pass. Stahl going deep. Looking downfield, and the pass incomplete. They tried to get it to Turner, and he couldn't hang on.
Really a good call. I think those are ones you like to see the big receiver go up and high point it. Really didn't high point the ball as well as maybe he could have.
When you say high point, you mean just go up and get it at its highest point when it's coming down?
Exactly right. And watch the play action here. Nice fake in the line of scrimmage. Good protection. Now, come back and get the ball. High point the ball. Get your highest point. You're tall. You got vertical leap. Get up and get the football. It's yours. Ball's in the air, it's yours.
Trying to spread the field just a little bit too, but now faced with a 3rd and 8. From the shotgun, Stahl. Quick hitter to the outside. And you run for the first down. No. The yards after the catch, not enough. And it looks like the punting unit is going to have to come out again. Turner got it, but only gets to the 31-yard line. And he needed another yard.
You can see in the body language of the Bowling Green Falcons how they're into this game pretty good. Obviously, they're ahead. It's the first time they've been ahead the entire game, and you can tell they've got energy. and they're ready to compete. It's going to be a challenge for the Panthers for this rest of the third and fourth quarters.
Well, the momentum has really switched. Remember the first drive by Pitt, they took it right down the field, marched in for a score. First three possessions for Bowling Green, they didn't even pick up a first down and had one intercepted. Brightus. That kick is muffed by Partridge, but he's able to fall back on the ball. So Partridge, a heads-up play, as he is able to get it at the 21-yard line. We're at Heinz Field in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. College football presented by Allstate on ESPNU. With Larry Coker, I'm Dave Armstrong, watching 25th-ranked Pittsburgh take on Bowling Green from the MAC. And right now, it's Bowling Green riding the ship here on the shores of the Allegheny.
They have ridden the ship. They really have. You look at the first quarter and you think this is going to be a blowout football game. Bowling Green, they stayed with it, stayed the course.
I really admire their offensive coordinators and their coach, Greg Brandon, for what they've been able to do, especially after the first three drives. It looked like this was going to be one of those easy days for the Pitt Panthers.
They had negative plays in the first three drives.
Big drive here for both these teams. Quick hitter across the middle. Bullock has been a big factor today. So to the 25-yard line as we get you to Low Galindo with another update.
Guys, how about another true freshman, this time out of Gainesville? Jeff Dimps has the fastest 100-meter dash time ever for an American teenager. Here is some of that speed from the ESPNU 150 to a touchdown. Gators up.
Boy, but could he catch Usain Bolt? He's fast, though. Hitter to the outside. Pass is caught out there by Hudson. Ray Hudson with the grab, and he takes it up to the 27-yard line.
You got a lot of pressure by the Pitt defense and a screen play by Bowling Green. And here's McKillop coming in, and I think really disrupted the throw. And good pursuit by the Pitt defense and good tackling to keep him short of the first down.
And the crowd gets into it here on third and three. Low snap. Sheehan has a scramble for it and still able to get it outside to Chris Wright for the first down. Boy, what a good play there by Sheehan.
That is really frustrating for the Pittsburgh defense because a bad snap. They had good pressure. But again, a good play by Sheehan.
Now Mick Williams down. He is one of the best interior linemen that Pitt has.
I think you're seeing some cramping going on. Again, very humid in Pittsburgh today. A little overcast early in the day, but bright sun today. It's a tough day to play.
No matter how many times you tell the players, fluids, guys. It still sometimes comes up and gets you. You're going hard on every play in this kind of humidity. You lose a lot of fluids.
We used to make our players on Friday nights before they go to bed drink like two Gatorades before they could leave the meeting room and go to bed. Because you say drink fluids, and maybe they will, maybe they won't. Mm-hmm. You've got to stand over them and make sure that they're hydrated.
Well, accountability even to the Gatorade.
Exactly.
So that's a first down. First down here for Bowling Green. And for the 29-yard line. Or excuse me, the 34-yard line. In, out to the flat. That pass is caught by Turner. We've seen all over the field. And Turner is hit out of bounds at the 36-yard line.
You can see now the ball is really getting out of Sheehan's hand quickly. And he's throwing the ball very accurately to the receivers, allowing them to make a catch, turn up field, and run. Not a big game, 2-3 yard gains, but that's positive.
Yeah, we were talking earlier about how it looked like Bowling Green was totally out of rhythm. They're in rhythm now.
They're in rhythm. They're dancing with the stars right now.
Second and eight. And knocked away. Good play defensively by McKillop.
Outstanding. Outstanding play. Good break on the ball. Nice break, sets up, and really nice job, knocks the ball away. A little tougher third down situation now.
Play clock down to 12. Third and eight. Here comes the blitz. Sheehan trying to throw a screen, and they had that covered. Bullock never got out of the traffic. And Bowling Green is going to be forced to punt.
The Bowling Green coaches wanted an interference call there, but the ball thrown behind the line of scrimmage, there really is no pass interference. Probably a good call by the official.
That time it looked like Phil Bennett said, you know, I've had enough of this little, you guys chipping us to death. Let's just bring the house.
Well, they are chipping Pittsburgh to death. And, you know, they can if Bowling Green can shorten this game and maintain possession of the ball, it's really tough for Pittsburgh to win.
Here comes the punt from Iovanelli. High punt. And it backs right all the way up to his 11. Right, though, with a nice return up to the 25-yard line, a 14-yard return.
That's a great punt, and good job fielding the football and getting upfield. So many punt returners want to dance and move around, attack the field, and pretty good field position, 25-yard line, considering where he fielded the punt.
A lot of great games in this first full weekend of college football on the ESPN family of networks, including ESPNU. Don't forget, on ABC, it's USC and Virginia. Appalachian State had to play earlier today because of the storm on the Classic. Alabama, Clemson, Illinois, Missouri, and Tennessee, UCLA. A great day of football viewing for you. McCoy, he goes out of bounds at the 30-yard line with 6 seconds remaining in the third quarter.
Just, Pittsburgh is physical, but Bowling Green's playing pretty physical, too. They're finishing up their tackles and really in some punishing hits on the running backs from Pittsburgh.
And tough go for McCoy today. And again, one of the points of emphasis for the Falcons has been to stop the run. And they'll run the clock, and that will be the end of the third quarter of play. But a third quarter really dominated by the Falcons, both in terms of time of possession. They get the score to take the lead going into quarter number four. Touchdown by Anthony Turner has given Bowling Green the surprising lead over 25th-ranked Pittsburgh as we head to the fourth quarter of play. College football presented by Allstate on ESPNU. It's the Falcons stunning the Panthers 20-17. It's Pitt with the ball, and they're faced with a second down, second and five. Sean McCoy, by the way, today has been held to 63 yards on 20 carries. To the outside, the catch is made and inbounds. What a fine catch out there by Cedric McGee. He's got good hands.
He's got really soft hands, really nice job. Using his body, really stretching out, knowing where the boundary is. In college football, you only need to have one foot in ground. I believe that would have been a catch in professional football. I think now it's prove it time for the Panthers. We talk about prove it.
Yep.
It's prove it time. It's fourth quarter, prove it.
One of the mantras that Dave Wonstadt came up with, he was tired of everybody talking about the West Virginia game and the big win they had at the end of last year. He said, you know what, that doesn't do anything for us this year. It's time to prove it. Again, the quick hitter, that's one to Nate Byam. And Byam able to get up to the 46-yard line. When you look at the yards by quarters, you can see a momentum shift in this game. Look, just 6 yards for Bowling Green in that first quarter. Then 137 in the second quarter. They've continued that dominance in the third quarter. Just 34 yards for Pitt in the third quarter. Well, and now yardage are almost even.
They've controlled the football and were able to make first downs. They haven't gotten really any big plays. I'm talking about Bowling Green, but they've got some first down plays. They've moved the chains.
Again, McCoy, I take it back, 55 yards today. He's had 8 yards in loss today. And again, a quick hitter, this one to Turner. Looking for some extra yards after the catch. He's got the first down. Wrestled down at the 43-yard line.
Well, good job by Turner protecting the football. A lot of traffic there. Nice little powerful run after catch to make a couple of additional yards. But the main thing, ball possession, keep the drive alive, keep it moving.
11-yard gain there. Warren sat nervously pacing those sidelines today, and you see him limping a little bit. He suffered an Achilles injury last year that continues on into this season.
Those are very severe injuries. It takes a long time to heal.
Especially the older you get.
No question.
On this first down play, a floater out here to McGee. Look at him run hard after the catch. Then he fumbled the ball. I heard a whistle. I thought I heard a little bit of a toot. Picking up the ball is Lewis and going into the end zone. Did you hear a whistle or was that just me?
I thought I heard a whistle, and it's going to be interesting to see what the officials decide on this, because I'm almost positive I heard a whistle.
64 yards if it stands for Kenny Lewis. And they're going to take several looks at this one.
This is a huge call.
We'll see what they decide right now. The referee, Randy Smith, trying to sort it out with his staff. And they're pointing back to the spot where he went down.
There was an inadvertent whistle on the play after Bowling Green recovered the ball. Be first and 10 Bowling Green at the spot of the beanbag.
So I did hear a whistle. Let's look, and coach will listen too for the whistle. There you heard the whistle. And I'm not so sure that McGee wasn't down when the ball came out.
Dave Wansted has a challenge here, so he may want to challenge this play.
The call on the field was that the ball came out before McGee hit the ground. Now, you definitely heard that little whistle, and then the official said there was an inadvertent whistle. So the call on the field is that this is a fumble by McGee and then picked up and run into the end zone, but they'll mark it at the spot when the whistle happened.
I think the mistake was made with the inadvertent whistle. I think it is a fumble. I don't think he's down.
Yeah, the ball is coming out. You're right.
I think it's probably a good correction by the official. The inadvertent whistle caused Bowling Green a touchdown on the play.
It did. And I think that's what Wansett was first upset about. He heard that whistle. I heard the whistle as Kenny Lewis was running down the sideline. And right now, if you're Greg Brandon, you're really upset because the officials, in a sense, have cost you a touchdown.
You're really upset, but there's nothing you can do about it. That's the rule's pretty plain and clear, and it's not going to be a touchdown. You can be upset, but hey, forget about it. You have the football. Now you've got it's the fourth quarter. You've got the lead. You've got a chance to put this game away.
You mentioned a coach's challenge here, and you wonder. The challenge on the whistle, we definitely heard the whistle, so you don't think they're going to challenge that. But a coach gets one challenge per game. He retains the challenge if that first one is successful. The most challenges you can have in a game are two. That's a new rule this year.
I don't think they'll challenge it. The only challenge I think would be there would be, well,
Wansted.
Was his knee down? Mm-hmm. Yes, the Pittsburgh coach Wansted, was his knee down before he fumbled, and his knee was not down.
Yeah, watch it here, and this is our best angle. Right here, you're going to watch as they turn him around.
Ball's out.
And the ball's coming out there, and he is still not on the ground. Now he's down. Now the ball comes out. And then off to the races goes Kenny Lewis, and then a little tweet of a whistle. The way the play is called right now, it will be Bowling Green's ball at their own 33-yard line.
I think that's what you're going to see. I think it's going to be Bowling Green's ball at the 33. Inadvertent whistle.
McGee was fighting for that extra yard. Now here's Randy Smith.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. The fumble recovered by Bowling Green and an inadvertent whistle. The ball will be placed on the 35-yard line. Please reset the clock to 13:30.
Well, they got it right, but they got it wrong.
Yeah, that's a huge, huge mistake or an error by the official. Again, this is their first game also.
Yeah.
And they're going to get better. You hate to see a call like that cost someone the football game, and maybe it won't. But this is a huge play in the game.
I mean, what I say is they got it right. They got it right in terms of the way it finally ended up. But they got it wrong in terms of that inadvertent whistle that, at least for the moment, has cost Bowling Green a touchdown. So after all that is sorted out, and Wonstadt's still not happy, but he kind of should be because his team bailed out by that whistle. And here comes Barnes on the run as he goes to the right side.
Yeah, I think Pittsburgh was a little fortunate there because they still have an opportunity to play defense and shut Bowling Green down and get the football back.
But again, Pitt was starting to move the ball offensively, Coach. And then yet another turnover. That's two turnovers in this game now, something that really cost them a lot last year, and it's rearing its ugly head again here this year.
Yes.
Here comes the blitz again. Sheehan's going to throw it up. Partridge not near the ball, and good coverage out there by DeSico. As we get you back to Lowell Galindo with another update from the studio.
Well, guys, we got a ball game in Charlotte. 2:30 left to play, and East Carolina within two because Patrick Pinckney, 3-yard touchdown run. Remember, Virginia Tech blocked an extra point, returned it for the 2-point conversion. That is the difference.
Well, how about that? That would be a shocker across the nation. Virginia Tech trying to hang on against Eastern Carolina.
East Carolina's a good program. Skip Holtz has done a great job there.
Low snap. Here comes pressure. Well, Sheehan was drilled as he threw the ball. Absolutely drilled, and that caused the ball to go a little bit off target.
Well, that's great pressure, and no doubt about it. It did cause it to go off target. And really, Pittsburgh is really starting to be aggressive again, and I think that's what that the defensive coordinators and the coaches want to see the Pitt defense do.
Yeah, instead of being back on their heels, they're kind of taking it to Bowling Green right now.
Yes, and that's what was good for them in the first quarter. That's what they need to do in the fourth quarter.
So are we getting another momentum shift here? That's if Pitt can hang on to the ball. This one off the side of the foot. And it goes out of bounds as Wright came over to take a peek. Or Aaron Berry, I should say. It will be Pitt's ball. They'll get it back at their own 24 when we return. ESPNU College Football is presented by Allstate. Proud sponsors of college football. Are you in good hands? And in part by Jack Link's Beef Jerky. Feed your wild side. With former coach Larry Coker, I'm Dave Armstrong. Bowling Green leading 20-17, 12:53 remaining as they forge that steel in these foundries here in Pittsburgh, the steel city of Pittsburgh. And right now will it be the Panthers throwing the last punch. It's been Bowling Green really since midway through that second quarter. And now a defining moment for both of these teams as Pitt starts at their own 25. Pitch back, and again it's Stevens howling as he's able to get it along the right side, a gain of 4-3 up to the 28. When you look at Pitt, they have dominated the MAC conference 25-2 all time, and they've never lost a season opener against the MAC. They have won 10 of their last 11 season openers overall and 8-0 to open the season against a team from the MAC.
Pitt doesn't need to panic. They've got a lot of time left, but they need to put together a drive.
Play action again, and the ball is knocked away from Stahl. They're not ruling that a forward pass. Instead, it's another fumble, the third turnover for the Panthers. Magnone was the one to get in there and create the havoc.
The Bowling Green defense is just creating some huge plays in the second half.
And again, the call on the field, his arm was not coming forward. And a big recovery here for Magnone. So Bowling Green trying to take advantage of the third turnover of the day.
You can see the right side of the pit line gets beat. Really blindsided Stahl, and he really had no chance there.
Here comes the blitz again. Sheehan lets it go, almost picked off. Boy, in and out of the arms there of Eric Thatcher.
Again, not a lot of interceptions last year for the Pitt secondary, and I know Phil Bennett would like to change that. And red zone defense was something he wanted to improve on, and this is a great time to start that improvement.
Seen a lot more blitzing coming from the Panthers of late. And Sheehan, 0 for his last five. Second and 10. At the 11-yard line. Pitt coming again. Sheehan to run with it into the end zone for the touchdown. Wow! The Panthers left the middle bare, and Sheehan ran right through the gut for the touchdown.
Sheehan's not a great runner. Normally they've substituted him for the quarterback position, but you can see the right side of the line. Nice pull, nice kick-out block. Pittsburgh had the blitz call. Great call by the Bowling Green offense. And great execution.
Well, we had an earlier shot of PNC Park, and it reminds you of baseball and Yogi Berra. And is it deja vu all over again for Pitt? Remember, turnovers so costly to them a year ago. Turnovers costly again here today. Three of them, two of them resulting in Bowling Green scores. Well, Tyler Sheehan, who had three rushing touchdowns last year, he takes advantage of the pressure from Pitt and the blitz, and he runs right through the gut for a touchdown. Well, Saturday afternoon college football continues here on ESPNU HD. It's the Delaware Blue Hens taking on the Maryland Terrapins. ESPNU college football presented by Allstate at 3:45 Eastern. So now Pitt really backed up against the wall here. And we come back to that two-word mantra from Dave Wanstead, prove it. Right now, they're not proving it because they're turning the ball over.
Well, they're not proving it, and now the whole dynamics has changed now. It's a fourth quarter, 12 minutes to go in the game, and now it's a two-score game. It's not a one-score game. So this is, again, it is time to prove it.
If you're the offensive coordinator of Pitt, the ball came off the tee before he got there. If you're the offensive coordinator, do you start to open things up a little bit? Do you panic a little bit? You still have 12 minutes to go.
Well, as an offensive coordinator, you don't want to use the word panic.
Right, right.
But if you're a head coach right now, you're probably in a little bit of a panic.
Yes, you are.
You've got to make plays. You've got to get the ball downfield. And you really haven't stopped to stop Bowling Green that well the second half. So you need to score and probably need to speed your tempo up, not necessarily panic.
Three turnovers today by Pitt, two of them leading to scores. The other one should have, if not for an inadvertent whistle. It would have led to a score, directly led to a score. Right out of the end zone. Good decision? We'll see, no. As he has stopped at the 15, but again, turnovers, a huge part of the Pitt story.
Well, sometimes you have turnovers and you don't, they don't hurt you that much. Their turnovers have been devastating.
Turnover led to that touchdown, and this turnover here ultimately leads to the touchdown run by Sheehan. And again, the other turnover, the fumble by Cedric McGee, it was only stopped from being a score because of an inadvertent whistle. And starting at their own 15 now, Pitt. And a dump off to McCoy. That's one way to get him involved as he gets it up to the 27-yard line, and we get you to Lowell Galindo.
Just seconds away from the first upset of the season because Beamer ball backfires. TJ Lee returns the block punt for East Carolina. 6 seconds left. Pirates up by five.
Unbelievable. East Carolina, and will it be followed closely by Bowling Green coming in here to stop 25th-ranked Pitt? Still under, just under 11 and a half to go. Sheehan again dumps it off. McCoy, a couple of moves, enough for another first down. Look at the Big East Conference this year. Some of the storylines that we'll be following The Mighty Mountaineers, number 8, and third straight preseason top 10. And, of course, South Florida, I think they're dangerous, Coach, and they keep building and building and building great recruiting year after year. And here's Pitt, the third of the Big East teams for in the top 25.
Yeah, the Big East has been a good league and probably doesn't get the respect that it deserves, but a very good league. And you're right about South Florida. I think Jim Leavitt and his staff have done a great job there, and really facilities and a lot of positives.
McCoy again stood up at the line, a short gain, gain of only 2. Yards have been tough to get for McCoy today.
They've been tough to get, and you talk about the upsets. People talk about the 85 scholarship limit really leveled the playing field. I think part of that's true, but they've had, that's been in place for a long time. I think the thing that's leveled the playing field has been the spread offenses. They've really spread the field and allowed the personnel to mismatch.
Second and 8. Stall. Dancing around a little bit. Gets it to McCoy. And he is immediately hit after the catch. Able to get it up to the 44-yard line. And it's going to bring up a third and about 4. You're almost into 2 down territory.
Yeah, this is a crucial drive here.
Big play here on 3rd and 4. Stall steps up. With good hands again by Byam as he was hit just as the ball arrived. Hit hard in there by P.J. Mahone, but Byam able to hang on.
That's a nice presence by Stull. Great job. And Byam, he's really done a nice job today. And that was a good break on the ball, good hit. But really nice hands putting the ball away. Very impressive play by Byam.
And a huge third down pickup for Pitt. So now they're into Bowling Green territory at the 44. Stall, quick drop, quick hitter, incomplete. Pass intended for McGee. This time he couldn't hang on.
They've had a couple of drops, Pitt has, but they've caught the ball pretty well all in all. You're at the position in the ball game now. Again, you've got to prove it. You've got to make those plays. Somebody's got to come up and make some plays to win the football game. Byam made a great play for a first down. Now he's got to have some help by his teammates.
So 24 of 35 today. Second and 10. Ball to the outside, almost picked. Boy, breaking hard on the ball, Antonio Smith.
That was a fantastic break, and I think you'll see the Pittsburgh offense now in a position they don't want to be in. They're forced into playing a game they don't want to play. They want to be ahead, so now they can mix in LeSean McCoy and really kind of control the tempo of the game. Bowling Green now is in control. They have the tempo of the football game. They're forced Pitt into really playing, what I say, playing left-handed.
Well, you never leave, folks, after the first drive of a game. Because it looked like it was going to be an easy day for Pitt at that point. You know, another big third down play for Stahl and company. Stahl given time, looking for an open receiver, doesn't find one. Now throwing on the run, and again, almost another interception. Threw it right into the arms of Dozier, who didn't hang on. Now you're faced with a 4th and 10. Do you go for it here?
I don't think you do here. You still got a lot of time. You still have timeouts left. But I think you punt. You still got nearly 9 minutes left in the football game. You don't make it here, it's going to be tough.
Now, I don't see the punting unit coming out. It looks like Dave Wonsett, Matt Cavanaugh, they're going to roll the dice right here on a 4th down play. Stahl gets it out to the wing and right through the hands of Kinder. Incomplete, and Pitt turns it over on downs.
Well, plus it would not have been a first down had he made the catch. So that was almost a zero play for Pitt. I don't blame the Pitt coaches for going for it. Again, the momentum has gone a little bit to the Bowling Green offense. They've done a good job and control the ball. You really don't want to get it back to them. But that it just didn't work this time.
Now, if you're Bowling Green, you want to try to eat up as much clock. Can you do that from the spread?
I think you can, because I think you can move around. You can play the different quarterbacks, the running quarterbacks, and kind of hammer it up a little bit, make Pitt use their timeouts. It's a two-score game.
That's what they're doing, bringing the running quarterbacks into play. It's Freddie Barnes behind center. They snap to Barnes. A little delay. He runs and gains a couple of yards before he's hit by McKillop.
What you'd like to see is a three and out if you're Pittsburgh, because, again, you're Bowling Green, you might be thinking, you know what, this is probably not going to make us a first down. We need to make some first downs.
Remember that 40-second play clock now coming into play, because it forces the offense to kind of move a little bit quicker than maybe they want to, because right now if you're Bowling Green, you want to try to take the air out of the ball.
Exactly.
And again, it's Barnes behind center. Barnes on the delay, this time hit behind the line and shoved way back.
I think you see what I'm talking about. They're really not making this. This is the way they started the game, the same type of offense, and it's just not working for them. I understand why they're doing it. They want to milk the clock and use as much time, but they need to make some first downs.
Brings up a third down play at the 45. They need to reach the 45, basically, of Pitt. They're 7 of 15 on third down today. That's excellent. Milking the clock down under 7.5 minutes to go. And they're forced to take a timeout because the play clock had gotten down to one.
That's probably not a bad call by Bowling Green, because, again, play clock by one. The coach on the boundary can call the timeout.
7:22 to go. 7:22 for Bowling Green to sweat things out. Bowling Green right now leading 27-17. This wouldn't be in the shocker category after all. Bowling Green did win 8 games last year and they're favored to win the MAC East. But Pitt comes in with a preseason number 25 ranking. They took the early lead in this game, but Bowling Green has taken it to them since that second quarter. Third and long here, 3rd and 8 for Bowling Green. Sheehan trying to run the draw. And he is going to be stuffed for no gain again. So bring out the punting unit for the Falcons. Right there, they just wanted to make sure they didn't turn the ball over.
I think they did. And I think Pittsburgh might be wise to use a timeout here. This is going to waste a lot of time as they're changing. And they've got timeouts. They probably would have been well advised to use one there.
Instead, they'll let the clock wind down, and Bowling Green in no particular hurry here. Play clock is down to 12.
And again, it's a two-score game. Pitt has to score twice.
Mm-hmm. Ivanelli on to punt. Barry, well, this is a good punt. Looks like it's going into the end zone, though. It does. And it'll bring it out to the 20-yard line. That was right at the goal line. Look at Bowling Green's defense today against McCoy. McCoy has really been bottled up, and then this turnover, the whistle stopped it from being a touchdown. That turnover, though, ultimately they do get a touchdown. 3 turnovers today for Pitt, and Bowling Green has taken advantage of that. So from Heinz Field in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, it's ESPNU College Football presented by Allstate with Larry Coker. I'm Dave Armstrong, seeing if Pitt can come back now, trailing by 2 scores late in the fourth quarter. McCoy gets it on the screen, and he's able to gain about 9 yards on first down. But McCoy not able to run the ball. He's looking at the takeaways today. One interception early by Pitt, but since then 3 turnovers by Pitt themselves. Bowling Green able to take advantage off of those turnovers. And now a flag blows this play dead.
False start, 77 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, 2nd down.
That's the left tackle, Jason Pinkston.
You got to be poised here again. You can't panic. Be poised and just execute your offense. You're playing against yourself now. And Bowling Green, they're playing against the clock.
Under 6 minutes to go. Second and six. Stall hit before he can unleash the ball. And again, the tackles are replaced. And now you're going to have some celebrating going on by Briggs, who comes in with the sack. A penalty against Briggs after the sack.
Sportsmanlike conduct, excessive celebration, 99 on the defense. It's a 15-yard penalty.
Well, that's a tough call, but I think it's a good call.
The result of the penalty will be a first down.
That's a mental mistake, and you're Bowling Green. You're in position to win a huge football game. That's the last thing you want to see. You appreciate Briggs, his effort. But again, you've got to be poised, and you've got to do things to help your team win. That did not help his team win.
Now, the sack did. The celebration did not.
The sack did, but the sack was nullified because of the celebration and then the penalty.
So now to the 32-yard line. And you look at Greg Brandon sweating it out. Last year they beat Minnesota from the Big Ten to start the season. That one went overtime. Now trying to knock off Pitt in their backyard. McCoy on the draw. Boy, he was one step away from breaking free. Still breaks through for 11 yards on first down.
Those are things they need to do. They need to just keep chipping away and hopefully win this football game or somehow score and put it into overtime.
Stall. Plenty of time to throw. There is a flag thrown. The pass completed just across midfield, completed to McGee. We'll see what the flag is about. Our officials crew from the Big East today. They're going to take the play and the resulting first down.
Illegal substitution. The 12th player on the defense was leaving the field when the ball was snapped. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Forget ESPNU, now available in high definition. To get the great action on ESPNU in high definition, contact your local cable operator or satellite provider. ESPNU HD, the big picture in college sports. Up to the 49-yard line now. A whistle will blow this play dead.
You see, Pittsburgh has struggled some in pass protection. Their tackles have gotten beat some, and they have new tackles this year. That is a tough position in pass protection. A key position in pass protection are the tackles.
They move the play clock to 25 after that penalty. Now Stahl, he wants it all down the sideline. It passes caught, but out of bounds. Jonathan Baldwin, the true freshman with the grab, but he was out of bounds.
Again, a huge play. I think that's a play that he's going to make in the future and make that catch, an outstanding catch. But you have to know where the boundary is. Give your quarterback room on the boundary. And again, that's a good call to the official.
You can see it's clearly out of bounds as the ball arrives.
That was a big play that the Panthers needed.
So second and five. Across the middle, boy, throwing into traffic Stall, trying to somehow get it into Dickerson, and incomplete.
Probably a bad read there, a bad decision. Dickerson was covered. The out route was open. Probably could have come underneath to the out route.
Clock just over 5 minutes. Dave Wonstadt, his mantra to his team before the season began, prove it. But three turnovers, costly today for the Panthers. Turnovers that reared their ugly head last year, certainly. Minus six in the takeaway department last year. And minus two today. Stahl just one for his last seven. And the draw play, not enough for the first down. And they're going to go for it again, I'm sure, as McCoy stopped after a gain of only two. Fourth and three.
No doubt about it. I think they will go for it. They'll have to. I'm really impressed with the Bowling Green defense, the way they're tackling, especially this second half. They're really doing a good job on McCoy. Not much running game the second half for Pittsburgh.
Briggs, who had that earlier celebration, now down. Probably another leg cramp. We're only speculating, but that has taken down a couple of players on a very warm and humid day here in Pittsburgh. We hope that's all it is for Dyrell Briggs, who was first team All-MAC a year ago. Interesting in talking to Dave Wonstadt yesterday, Coach. One of the last things he said to us is we just got to hang on to the ball. I mean, last year, all the turnovers, A lot of them freshman mistakes, but it wasn't the freshmen today. Three turnovers, all by upperclassmen.
You need to see those freshmen grow up, and I know that Coach Wanstead wanted to see them grow up more today, and I know there's some disappointment there. The turnovers, I know Dave's background, how he coaches against turnovers, protecting the football, and really a disappointing day today in some areas.
And again, a day that started so well for Pitt. They got the opening drive, marched right down the field. McCoy scored the early touchdown. Bowling Green was held to just 6 yards in the first quarter. But those three turnovers costing Pitt 14 points today. And if you're just joining us, actually the third turnover should have resulted in another Falcon touchdown, but an inadvertent whistle blew the play dead before they could score.
And the Pitt defense held Bowling Green on that series.
Mm-hmm. Now fourth and three. Game definitely on the line here. Stall. He's got the first down and then some. Cedric McGee comes up big down to the 35-yard line to keep the hopes alive for the Panthers. Stall throws it up into the end zone. A penalty flag thrown at the 20-yard line, and the pass incomplete. Intended for Derek Kinder.
Well, they're trying to get the ball in the hands of the playmakers.
The defense, number four. 10-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Like Jarrett Sanderson, the linebacker, was beat on the play, and he held on.
Well, good job by Stahl getting the ball up and the receiver hopefully get hands on it.
Well, the penalty is starting to add up a little bit on Bowling Green today. If you're Greg Brandon, the head coach of the Falcons, you just want that clock to just keep moving.
Yeah, you're playing the clock now. You're not playing Pittsburgh. The clock's on your side. It just needs to run for you.
Ball spotted at the 25, first down. Stahl. He steps up and again throws it into double coverage. Pass intended again for Dickerson. And incomplete. Stops the clock with 4:12 remaining.
I think Greg Brandon may look back at the series before. He might have changed his attitude a little bit about three conservative plays there that netted really no yards, especially if Pittsburgh scores on this series with time left.
Second and 10. Stall. That's incomplete. An adjustment trying to be made by Nate Byam, who's really come up with some big plays from the tight end position today. But that one incomplete, and it's third and 10. Pitt, they have dominated the MAC conference. 2-0 against Bowling Green. Those two games almost a decade ago. Only lost two games, and both of those on the road to MAC teams. They're 8-0 in season openers against the MAC. But today, they are behind by 10 with just over 4 minutes to go and a third down play here. Incomplete. The out pattern to the outside to Aaron Smith, and he can't hang on.
Well, you're not going to pass it any better than that. That's a great protection and a great pass. Nice stall, and again, you've got to make that catch.
Field goal unit comes out now, Coach. You need two scores, this being one of them.
This will be one of them. You've got the best kicker in the Big East Conference, 83% success ratio. Probably a good call here. You need points on this drive.
Connor Lee hit a 37-yard field goal earlier. This one he is attempting from 43 yards out. And it is no good. Connor Lee, one of the most accurate kickers in the game, missing there to compound the problems for the Panthers today.
Well, the trajectory was low. It looks like he didn't hit the ball very well, but that's a huge, a good call by the Pitt offense to go for the field goal. You've got the best kicker in the Big East Conference. Get points.
You did need two scores there, and Connor Lee, who prides himself, he's never, ever missed an extra point. Now so upset there, and again, they need two scores. I agree with you, Coach. They needed to get 10 points somehow. They were facing a fourth and long. Go for the field goal there, get the 3 points, and then come back for the touchdown later on. And the reason they were able to do that there is because Bowling Green had a extra point blocked earlier in this contest. But now Bowling Green, again, they go to their running quarterback. Freddie Barnes is really a wide receiver. But Barnes is trying to eat some time and hang on to the ball. There is a penalty flag thrown into the line of scrimmage.
You might want to decline this penalty. You'd rather have the down than the penalty here, but
be a holding call against Bowling Green. I agree with you there too.
We have two flags on the play. Holding, 76 on the offense. Face mask, 86 on the defense. Penalties offset, first down.
So they don't get the choice.
No. I think here, Bowling Green is what we call four-minute offense. Again, the clock is on their side. They don't need to score points. They need to use time. And again, a first down is huge. Make Pitt use their timeouts. Win the football game the surest way.
Well, you see all those fans filing out of Heinz Field now, Coach. Fans that really bought into the optimism that started last year with that upset win of West Virginia and carried all the way through the spring and the summer. And now this disappointing start for the Panthers here today.
Well, it's not over yet, but certainly a disappointing day so far. It might have been too easy early, Dave.
Yeah. Maybe so. Maybe they got a little bit complacent with that early score. Turner stopped here. But again, right now, all Bowling Green wants to do is run the clock and hang on to the ball. Another flag on this play.
No penalty on the play. Timeout. Pitt. Their first timeout.
So they'll take a timeout here and force a second and long. But you feel for coaches always, being a coach yourself, and Dave Wannstedt, he is one of these guys that was brought in here. This is his fourth year now, and a lot of folks said, oh, just the right choice, the former Pitt guy. He was an offensive lineman here back in the 70s. He was an assistant coach here when they won the national championship in 1976, all those years in the NFL, all those great years in college football. But it just hasn't happened. This is fourth year now, and he has a sub-500 record.
Well, I think nobody more disappointed than Dave Wannstedt, because he loves this program. He has a passion for this city. He has a passion for Pitt football. And I think he's certainly disappointed, but it's a long season. There's a lot of football left.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. But, again, he is going to say, I'm sure, in his postgame conference, guys, same problem we had last year, hanging on to the ball. Three turnovers today, very costly. Again, right here, all you're trying to do if you're Turner is hang on to the football, make sure you don't fumble it. Keep the clock moving, force Pitt to use a timeout, which they will. Here's their second timeout, only one remaining now, and these are anxious moments for Greg Brandon.
Not as anxious as they are for Dave Wannstedt.
Yeah, you're right. Dave Wannstedt to try to his team. Takes on Buffalo next week. And then a week off before they play the Iowa Hawkeyes. When you look at Pitt, they have not been to a bowl game in three straight years. There's only 11 teams out of 65 BCS conference teams that have not gone to a bowl in the last 3 years, Pitt being one of those. The other, Syracuse from the Big East, also includes Arizona, Baylor, Duke, Mississippi, Stanford, Vanderbilt, Washington, and Washington State. And what we notice from this list, four of those teams have new coaches this year, and there are a few others now that would have coaches on a hot seat.
I think the thing you see, too, Bowling Green went to a bowl game last year. Pittsburgh didn't. That allowed Bowling Green about 15 extra practices that the University of Pittsburgh didn't get. So, again, I think all those things are very important.
Absolutely. When Bowling Green, even though they got blown out by Tulsa in that GMAC bowl, they did get that extra practice. And the thing that impresses me most today about Bowling Green is the way they started. 6 yards in the first quarter. Looked like they were just going to get blown out of this place. And yet they were able to somehow gather some momentum, change their offense a little bit, call some kind of trick plays, and that really seemed to get them going and also created some havoc for the Pitt defense.
I think it put Pitt's defense on its heels just a little bit. And offensively, I don't think Pitt's really gotten in a rhythm today. They made some plays, but they really haven't been able to get to LeSean McCoy in the open that much, especially in the last three quarters and in the second half.
Well, you think now, too, with over 3 minutes to go, that missed field goal. Another bad punt here. Is going to be handled and then out of bounds. A little dangerous play there by Aaron Berry, but he's able to hang on to the ball, and Pitt will have it. It would be a miracle finish now with 2:48 remaining.
Well, it will be, and if you lose one like this, if you're Pittsburgh, there's got to be someone down the road that you beat somebody maybe you're not supposed to. Mm-hmm. When I was in Miami, we went to Washington, lost to a very good Washington team. We were a good football team. We beat West Virginia the next week. And we beat the number one team in the country at that time, Florida State, in the Orange Bowl. So I think, Corey, you've got to make one up somewhere down the road if you're Pitt and you lose this game.
Tough matchup anytime you take on a team with the spread offense, the quirkiness of that, how to match up defensively. And for the most part, when Pitt played aggressively today, they matched up very well, but they got back on their heels a little bit, and you have to give Greg Brandon and his offensive coaches credit for that because they put Pitt back on their heels.
Well, that's exactly right. I think they did, and I think the thing you have to think about is Greg Brandon knows this offense. He knows what to call, where to go, and the weaknesses of the defense and where to attack it.
Well, second and four. Stall. And knocked down. Good play by Jamal Brown coming up from his free safety position to knock that away. 2:23 remaining. And again, you see Jamal Brown come up to make that play. He just kind of sat on the receiver and waited for the pass to arrive. Now third down. Stall. And again, throwing it, trying in the direction of Turner, but it was well shy of the target, and Dozier almost picked it off. So now another fourth down.
Well, you've got a new quarterback in Stall, a young quarterback, and also young. He hasn't played that much, and I think you've got Pitt playing where they don't want to play, and that's behind. They want to get in control of the clock and be able to run the football, and now Bowling Green is in control of the football game.
One of the things that Bowling Green told us coming into this game, they wanted to make sure they stopped the run, and in particular, stopped LaShawn McCoy, who rushed for an average of better than 111 yards per game last year. But they stopped McCoy today, 23 carries, just 71 yards.
We don't have preseason games in college football, so your first live action against another opponent was today. So again, adjusting from practice speed to game speed. And they did that very, very well after the first quarter, adjusting to Pittsburgh's running game.
Fourth down completion there keeps Pitt's slim hopes alive. Now Stahl's going to be sacked. He stepped up right into the traffic. And again, not to harp on a point, but Pitt's offensive line retooled this year, and they've got some work to do.
Well, they do, especially you see the offensive tackles. But both tackles are new. They lost two really good tackles last year.
And because Pitt has been playing behind for much of the second half, Stahl has now attempted 50 passes today.
If we would have told Dave Wanstead that your quarterback's going to throw 50 times today, he would have been disappointed.
First down play, Stahl throws it up into the end zone, and it's picked off. It'll be the fourth turnover of the day for the Panthers. This one picked off in the end zone by Kenny Lewis, and the Bowling Green crowd starts to celebrate.
Well, they have reason to celebrate. Hopefully you'd like to see the receiver make a better effort for the football. The ball's thrown up. You've got to go get it. Pittsburgh's in a tough situation right now. And again, you just got to play the game out and do everything you can to try to make a play.
Four turnovers today for the Panthers. And now the exits are getting crammed with Panther fans.
I consider this an upset, but I don't consider it shocking. And Bowling Green is a good football team. They were good last year. They went to a bowl game. Got a lot of players coming back. Picked high in the MAC. They're a good football team.
It's going to be a gut check time now for the Panthers.
No doubt about it. I think that for them to have a good year, they've got to go to a bowl game, and they need to beat somebody maybe that they're not supposed to.
You look at it, two now. Top 25 teams going down today. Earlier, Virginia Tech, and now Pitt, number 25 team. And a lot of people thought, Well, it's sort of a misnomer because Pitt at 5-7 last year, they're the only top 25 team with a sub 500 record from a year ago.
I saw the tape of as you did of some Pitt practice film, and I was very impressed with them. And I don't think their rating was out of sorts. I think they're going to be a good football team, and I think they have some work to do without question. But I think they'll be a good team as the year progresses. Mm-hmm.
This is Anthony Turner down. Again, cramping has been a problem here in the fourth quarter for both teams. And again, we're hopeful that that's all it is, and the way they're stretching that leg out, it would appear that it would be a cramp. ...27-17, Bowling Green. And a game that started with Pitt dominating the first quarter.
Well, this is a proud tradition. This is a great football tradition. You look and you see 9 national titles. You see the Tony Dorsetts and the Martin Mays and the Dan Marinos, the great players that have played here. And the great facilities that Pitt has built. It's a tremendous athletic complex where they work out. And again, this is a setback, and maybe a major setback, but you got to make out of it what it is. And as Jimmy Johnston used to tell Dave Wanstead and me and all the staff, you have to press on.
We're coming up right after our game. Saturday afternoon college football continuing here on ESPNU HD. It's the Delaware Blue Hens taking on the Maryland Terrapins. ESPNU college football presented by Allstate at 3:45 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. 1:23 separating Bowling Green from their first victory of the year and creating for the Panthers a sense their mission has to restart again next week against Buffalo. But for Bowling Green, I mean, with their non-conference schedule, Coach, taking on Minnesota at home next week, then at Boise State and at Wyoming. Those four games in particular, that is a tough non-conference schedule. So to get one on the road at Pitt to start things off, hopes are really high now for Bowling Green.
Well, it really is. And I will tell you now, Greg Brandon's going to celebrate this for a few minutes. And then he's going to worry about his football team thinking they have all the answers. Now they've got to come back to ground zero and come back to earth and realize that there's some good football teams they've got to play. I promise you, you go to Boise, you better be ready to play.
Clock winding down now is going to run it out. Now, if I'd have told you this, with Pitt's offense, the way they moved the ball in the first half, here's their offense in the second half. Punt. Next possession, punt. Next possession, turnover. Next possession, turnover. Next possession, turnover on downs. Missed field goal, turnover. That's what happened in the second half for Pitt today. And there he is, Greg Brandon, the coach of Bowling Green, who comes in to shake hands with Dave Wanstead, who has to leave this field totally disappointed here today.
Well, you give yourself no chance. Those second half statistics that you mentioned, you have no chance to win. Against a good football team or a bad football team, it doesn't matter. You're not going to win when you do those type things.
4 turnovers today in Bowling Green. Their 10th win over a BCS conference team. Their first ever against the Pitt Panthers. And so for Bowling Green, they're able to wave the flag proudly as the Falcons come in here and stun Pittsburgh. I agree with you that it's not a stunning victory in terms of Bowling Green with 8 wins a year ago and Pitt coming off a 5-win season. But still, you come into Pitt's backyard, the number 25 team, and win. That's a big win for the Falcons.
That is a huge win for Bowling Green. Just don't diminish that at all.
Once again, our final score, Bowling Green 27, Pitt 17. For Larry Coker and our entire ESPNU crew, Dave Armstrong saying so long. Coming up next on ESPNU, it's SportsCenter U. For more information, log on to your home for the finest in college sports, ESPNU.com. The preceding has been an exclusive presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.